on Bowl Mania.
And we hope to add to that highlight reel tonight here in Mobile, Alabama, the Lending Tree Bowl, featuring the champions of the Mid-American Conference, Miami University's Redhawks, and the runners-up in the Sun Belt looking for an 11th win, the Ragin' Cajuns of Louisiana. You're watching the Lending Tree Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Joining me in the booth, Gene Chizik. I'm Dave Lamont. Lauren Sisler is handling the sidelines for us. And we know this is an opportunity for Louisiana to polish off the greatest season they've ever had. If they get to 11 wins, they've already got 10. This is the best they've ever done. And they've done it on the ground. But so we're going to not talk about that now. We'll get to that later. But we do want to talk about their quarterback, Levi Lewis.
Yeah, I like Levi Lewis. You know, he is the undisputed leader of this football team, Dave. And he does everything that a quarterback should do. He manages the team. He's an accurate intermediate passer. He's very protective of the football. He's got 24 touchdowns to only 4 interceptions. He's very accurate. And you know what? More than anything, this is a tough football player. He can run the ball, Dave. He can do more things than just throw the ball.
All right, so I want to tap into your defensive-oriented mind and ask you, how do you defend against a guy like that?
Well, Miami of Ohio is cut their teeth on creating negative plays. Tackles for loss, sacks. That's how they play defense. Look at this right here. This is the championship game. The offensive line's going to block 5 for 5. I want you to note the right tackle. He's got a decision to make. Does he stay inside on the potential blitzer inside, or does he block out to number 23, Ivan Pace? He goes inside, Pace comes outside. There's another sack. Dave, they're top 20 in the country in both tackles for loss and sacks.
So are we going to have a defensive-oriented low-scoring game or two offenses that are going to light it up? We are about to find out when we return to Mobile. Here in Mobile, Alabama for the Lending Tree Bowl. You know, Miami Redhawks won their 16th Mid-American Conference Championship just last month, but it has not always been great for them over the years. And with more on that, we turn to Lauren Sisler.
Yeah, when Chuck Martin arrived in Oxford in 2013, he sat down with each of the players and he asked them, why do you want to be at Miami? And of course, despite only scoring 9 touchdowns in that previous season, the guys didn't really care much about football. They wanted to be there and enjoy the college life. They wanted to get their degrees. Football wasn't a thing, but that has all changed by year 3 of Coach Martin's tenure. The mindset has shifted and a culture has been built for long-term success.
Well, this is going to be an interesting battle tonight, thank you, Lauren, of special teams, because these teams are both outstanding, and you're looking at a great kick returner you just saw there in Maurice Thomas. He and Tyre Shelton awaiting the kickoff from the Ragin' Cajuns, and this is going to be Thomas with a chance. He returned 197 yards to open the MAC championship game, and he takes off down the far sideline, and he'll be run out of bounds in between the 25 and 30 yard lines. Looks like it's going to be around the 26, and that's where we will see the freshman out of St. Louis on this 58-degree evening, Brett Gabbert. He is the MAC freshman of the year. He'll have Jalen Bester behind him, who's having a career season, and Bester has scored touchdowns in 9 straight. Gabbert, the first to ever open the season as a freshman in Miami football history at the quarterback position. On the ground, they start with Bester. And that Ragin' Cajun defense all over him for nothing, led by Benny Higgins, number 15, and Chris Moncrief. Second down and 10. First completion of the game is going to go to Jack Sorensen, a reliable receiver for this Miami team. He's going to gain 9, sets up 3rd down and a yard. Guerrer in there on the stop for the Cajuns.
That's going to be interesting here, Dave, to see what they do on this 3rd down. Normally they check to the sideline to make sure that they can get a perfect play on 3rd down. We'll see if that happens right now if they just line up and run it.
Davion Johnson is now the tailback. Gabbert goes under center, and the 6-foot quarterback is going to try to wiggle his way through there, and he did it. First down for Miami University.
Well, this is the recipe we're talking about, right? First downs, grind the ball out, play conservative offense, high percentage passes, Again, getting a first down, moving the chains. They're not in any hurry. They're not in a fast-paced offense. They're ready to just take this thing play by play, Dave, and then play great defense with them.
Would it be fair to say that a lower scoring game would favor the Red Hawks?
Without question. You know, these guys have confidence. If it's a one-score game, they'll win it.
That's Bester on the ground, right up the gut, and to the 41-yard line before he is brought down. Braylon Trahan among the tacklers there, number 24, a solid 3-yard pickup.
I think we got to watch tonight, Dave. I think the game plan for Miami is to run straight at these guys. They know they've got great speed on the perimeter. This team right now can run side to side. Miami prides himself on having big guys, physical guys up front, and those tailbones being able to hunker it downhill in there.
Second and 7. Gabbert, little tunnel screen here for Sorensen. Picked up one key block, and he'll get 4, maybe 5. But a very key block thrown that allowed him to break loose. Sorensen's an interesting study. He has been battling a foot injury all season long.
The screen game is a huge part of what Miami does. Again, it's kind of a very conservative offense. These are very safe plays. Not only the tunnel screens, they'll also throw the tailback slip screens. Anything that's a high percentage, easy pass for Gabbert. These guys have it in the playbook.
They got third down and a couple. It's Bester again, and this is, I don't think he made it, Gene. I think he's going to be about a yard short the middle of that defense led by Farrad Gardner, number 7, that brought him down. It will be fourth down.
It's going to be fourth down, and again, they said, I'm going to run the ball directly at Louisiana's defensive front. Louisiana's doing a great job right now of playing tough inside, sometimes with a shaded nose, sometimes with a 3 technique. They'll jump back and forth to a 3-man front, but they got the stop.
No surprise to see the Redhawks punt here. Chuck Martin likes to play a field position game. He thinks that's one of their strengths. Kyle Kramer, the punter, a 5th-year senior from Glen Ellyn, Illinois, is a very good one. Eric Gehrer will await this punt at the 10-yard line. Good snap. High kick. Good one. Fair catch called and made at the 8. And that, in a way, is Redhawks football. No question that they are very good at field position. We'll take a look at the night's keys to the game, brought to you by Academy Sports and Outdoors.
Yeah, Louisiana, I mean, what are they built on? They got to run the football. They got to avoid negative plays. This defense for Miami thrives on the negative plays. You're going to see multiple formations in tempo and special team explosives. They're going to have to do something to slow this Miami special teams down. And on the flip side, what does Miami got to do? Stop the run. They're going to run the ball straight down here. They can't have any turnovers. And you know what Chuck likes to do? Win the field position battle.
Well, he's got a little bit of an edge here against Levi Lewis in this raging Cajun offense. Calais, the back, splits out wide. And the lefty fires right down the middle, caught at the 16-yard line. And that's going to be probably all on forward progress. A lot of Redhawks defenders around the receiver that time. Second down and about 3 to go. Jamarcus Bradley wound up getting gang tackled and playing with some fast pace. This is Calais, who's fast. He gets to that edge. Calais down the sideline. He'll have a first down as he's shoved out of bounds outside the 20-yard line by Sterling Weatherford.
The first thing you're going to see with this offense is you're going to see tempo early in the game. They want to see how the defense responds to tempo. The next thing you're going to see is multiple formations. They're going to give you a lot of things. They're going to give you empty. They're going to give you jet sweeps. They're going to give you all the things that strain defenses to see how you respond to these.
It is Calais again looking for room. Didn't get a lot of it that time. Fighting off the block was Dean Lemon. And that's going to be a short one. Second out of 9 coming up. Calais stays in to the right of the quarterback, Lewis. Steps in, nice pocket long throw, and confusion there as it looked like Jalen Williams, the receiver, lost his footing, and the ball was never close to him. It'll be 3rd down and 9.
Yeah, obviously, when you throw the timing off of these routes, whether it's a stumble, whether the secondary, the defensive, the DB got his hands on him,
He was off sync because that throw probably would have been right on. Here we are, third down. It's going to be interesting. Watch the slot receiver at the top. Again, you're looking at a 2x2 formation. This is where they like to throw some vertical routes.
Elijah Mitchell is the tailback. He stays in the block, and there is a dart, a beautiful throw caught by Bradley, and he fumbled the football around the 48-yard line. I believe he got it back. What a fine throw by Lewis, and it will be first down for Louisiana.
Well, this is one thing that they cannot do. They cannot turn the ball over. This is a very opportunistic Miami of Ohio football team. This is a great strip. They thrive on turnovers. Great thing, Louisiana got the ball back. Again, you're looking at an empty formation.
Looking at Lewis taking off. We mentioned in the show he could run. He's going to slide a little bit short of the first down, but that's going to be second down and very short.
Yeah, and all he's doing in that, when you go with an empty formation, they're looking for numbers in the box. If they get the right numbers, they run the quarterback draw. If not, he'll throw it and kick it out.
Stay on the ground. This is Mitchell caught in the backfield for a loss, maybe of a yard there. Andrew Sharp, the redshirt sophomore from Grosse Pointe, Michigan, drives him back to third down and three.
This is where you see Louisiana not tempo, right? They've got to get in the right play. Now, they may check to the sideline on this, but they have to get on the right play. Tempo's not an issue in these.
Make it third down and two as the officials move the spot. They beef up the blocking with Ralston, the tight end, 22. This is Mitchell, and this is close. And the initial spot is he didn't make it, but let's see. These things sometimes change. Either way, Gene, I think they're going to go for it.
Yeah, I think this is a team that believes they can run the football. And again, Mitchell's a big back. He's 218 pounds. They got a couple guys that can slam it up in there. Watch for some jet sweep to misdirect the defense. But they're going to probably try to run the ball downhill. They believe in this offensive line, and they believe in their tailbacks.
Louisiana has converted six of their last seven on fourth down. And the battle here is the offensive play caller is the head coach for Louisiana. The defensive signal caller is the head coach for Miami. Oh, we got a false start with so much movement.
Offense, number 74. It's a 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Mike Roach, our referee from the American Conference. And that's the veteran, Max Mitchell. And Billy Napier's protests. He can have them. So now what do you do? I don't see a punter coming out here.
Well, it'd be interesting. You would think that, again, punting would be at least on the table, right? Punt it. Let's play some field position. If they don't do that, they feel really good about the confidence of their defense. Fourth and five, fourth and six is not usually, a point where you go for it this early in the game.
Well, the play clock, though, is down to two, down to one. And they may be taking the delay of game penalty here just to make it a little bit easier for Reese Burns, the punter. And everybody is cheering like that's one of the great turning points of the game. It just seems like
it's great strategy, right? Yes. Great strategy, exactly.
Even I know that. So we're going to see from Melbourne, Australia, and certainly our thoughts with the people of Australia who were affected by those horrible fires in that beautiful country. We don't want you to know that we're thinking about you. So Reese Burns will take care of the punt, but again, you kick to Maurice Thomas, you do so at your own risk. Line drive with some spin. Thomas watches it go, and that spin pays off handsomely. Down to about the 3-yard line, the 15th punt for Reese Burns inside the 20-yard line.
College football playoff national championship game. Number 1 LSU, number 3 Clemson, January 13th at 8 on ESPN.
So field position, Gene, has absolutely played a part in this, and good luck getting any field position in that pep rally that was so well attended the other night here in Mobile, as the town has embraced this Lending Tree Bowl every year. And for the Raging Cajun fans, not a terribly long trip, and for the folks out of Oxford, they have enjoyed their time here in Mobile. Gabbert taking the snap in the end zone. Gabbert comes out firing this time and hits again one more time, Sorensen. And that'll be a first down for the Redhawks.
You're looking at high percentage passes, right? We saw a jailbreak screen. We're seeing quick outs. We're seeing anything that's an easy access throw, particularly if the DBs are playing off. You're going to see a lot of easy access throws. And Gabbert will take them. He is not afraid to sit back there and throw the football.
He's had three connections, all of them to Sorensen for 29 yards. He looks that way again, and a fine catch at the 34-yard line, and it's Sorensen one more time with a first down. Four completions to him.
Sorensen is definitely his go-to guy. If you go back to the MAC championship game, eight catches, 123 yards. Look, this guy's been banged up some during the season, Dave, but tonight he's already got four receptions. He set his own record back in the MAC championship, and again, I think you're going to see him a lot tonight coming up with some good catches. He's his main target.
Yeah, guys, Brett Gabbert told us the greatest challenge he faced as a freshman was the speed of the game at this level. Things move a lot quicker. It's such a change up from when he was in high school. But after the season opener against Iowa, he said it really slowed down for him, allowing him to focus more on reading the defense and making better decisions. And obviously, it's showing up here tonight.
Lauren, thank you very much. You just saw Maurice Thomas run for a dozen and another Miami first down. They begin this drive at their own three. They're already at their own 46-yard line. Shelton in the backfield for the first time, gets the catch, bounces off a couple of good blocks, lowers his shoulder, and he is very close to another first down, and he did get it.
Tyree Shelton is a back that is extremely explosive. This guy averages over 5 yards a carry. They really like his physicality, too. He's only a 190-pound back, but he's got great vision. He can make cuts in the open field, and if he has to run you over, he has no problem putting his hat down and running you over.
He did it that time. Davion Johnson checks in as the Redhawks are rotating their tailbacks right now. They've used four in the game. Play action fake. Gabbert wants the deep shot. He's in trouble and down he goes. The first sack, the 31st sack of the season. Chris Moncrief, his fifth individually, a loss of five.
That's a huge play. And again, you're looking at a lot of rhythm here. They started back on their own 3 yard line. Here we are four plays later. They're almost out to the 50. Louisiana needed a negative play. That was a big play with great timing. Now, Louisiana could go into a little bit of exotic mode, right? Maybe move around a little bit, bring some different pressures and blitzes. We'll see. And I would be looking for Miami here. Screen passes, draws, something right now that is very high percentage in terms of success.
They face second down and 15. Gabbert fakes the screen. They go to traditional screen pass in the middle, and it may have been up incomplete. I thought for a moment that Chauncey Manak had come away with the ball, but it's going to be third down and 15 instead.
This is what Miami does, though. We talked earlier about screen game, jailback screen, tailback slip screens. These guys like the screen game. They're very proficient at it. That one didn't work out, but I'm going to tell you what, as this game unfolds, you're going to see more and more screens. They're typically going to come into a game with six or seven different screens that they can run.
Third down, 15. And they'll go to the ground. And Bester will not get very far at all. So again, the field position game perhaps on the mind of the Redhawks.
You know, that doesn't surprise me, Dave. Some people at home might be thinking, why did you run that on third and a zillion? Because that's the way Miami wins games, right?
Yep.
They play conservative when they have to play conservative. They're not going to turn the ball over. They're not going to put the ball in harm's way, throwing the football in the air. They're going to play field position. They're going to use their punter. They're going to use their coverage units to be able to create field position advantages, and that's what you see here.
Now Kyle Kramer pinned the Raging Cajuns back to the eight. Wow, this is forever high. My goodness, and he hooks it toward the sideline. Get me Kyle Kramer down to the two. Early nomination for the game's MVP award, Kyle Kramer.
The Lending Tree Bowl, brought to you by Lending Tree. shop and compare loans, credit cards, insurance, and more. And the first ever Mazda CX-30. Feel alive.
Mention the tremendous support for the city of Mobile, Alabama, and of course the fan bases from Oxford, Ohio, and Lafayette, Louisiana. Oh, yeah. By the way, the states of Ohio and Louisiana undefeated in the smaller conference. And Ohio State did lose, but otherwise, Kent State did well. In fact, a big win for Kent State. LSU, obviously. So we've been some success for these two states. Meantime, the field position fight continues. The worst field position so far goes to Louisiana. Levi Lewis from his end zone throws wide open receiver. Down to the 20, 30, the foot race is on. Down to the 45-yard line, the catch is made by Khalif Gussens.
I love the play call coming out. What does Louisiana do? They run the football down your throat. Great job of the boot right now. He sees the receiver. He's running wide open. Gossett brings the ball down. Great, almost 40-plus yard gain on that day. Puts him in a great position on first down.
43, as a matter of fact, for Gossett. Just his 14th catch on the year. Now back to the ground go the Raging Cajuns and Trey Regis, and he runs into a lot of resistance there. 2 yard gain and a lot of Red Hawks defenders in there on the stop.
Yeah, Ryan McWood did a great job of scouting that ball out. I really like him as an inside linebacker. He does a great job side to side. These linebackers for Miami, Miles Reed, Ryan McWood, they both do a great job of fitting the run, being where they're supposed to be. That's one of the main reasons this defense is so good.
A lot of motion. Here comes a double reverse. Miami read it, but that is Calais trying to make a minimal loss out of this, and Miami destroyed the play. Cameron Butler ends up sharing the tackle with Bart Ferrati. It's a loss of 10.
Well, I will tell you this. Cameron Butler leads the team in tackles for loss coming to the game with 14, and one of the reasons is because this Miami defense is disciplined. They stay at home. Normally when you're pursuing to the ball fast, you can catch the guys on any misdirection. Not with Mr. Butler. These guys do a great job. They're very disciplined, and that was a great way to finish.
Third down and 18, and under a minute in our opening quarter. They go to the ground. Playing it safe, although they have the ability to gash you, but that nothing there for Regis. Lonnie Phelps Jr., number 47, with a hit. And you can hear on our microphones how jacked up that Red Hawks sideline is. This is the game they want, Gene. They love this 0-0 at the end of the first quarter and what we're headed for.
Yeah, they feel very confident in any one-score game, Dave. That's what they're 5-0. They're undefeated in every one-score game that they've been in this year. And this is the kind of game they thrive on. They love it.
A lot of movement around here. Pre-punt for Reese Burns. Flag is down. This has a load of spin on it. Thomas will make the catch, and he's dangerous. Look at Thomas up the gut. Man, did he accelerate quickly. And he's going to get out to the 27-yard line. Now, let's see what the flag is all about. It was thrown just about a blink of an eye after the snap by the head linesman. I would think if it's on the Raging Cajuns, I'm declining.
Legal formation on the kicking team. That 5-yard penalty be added on to the end of the run. Because an accepted penalty concluded the quarter, will extend the quarter for one untimed down.
There you go. You know, you have to worry about that. You just get the untimed down. So the clock is run out. Now, we saw an untimed down earlier this year, and Western Kentucky beat Western Michigan on it. That was the fourth quarter. This is the end of the first quarter with this untimed down, and it will be about a 3-yard gain for the Red Hawks and Jalen Bester. And the first quarter is officially over. So you might wonder who would be happy with a 0-0 game? Chuck Martin in Miami is very happy. Beautiful mid-50 evening here in Mobile. We look back, and of course, these teams have the honor of visiting the USS Alabama. Just off the Gulf here. We had a pretty good view of that today at lunch. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on the water when you're in Mobile. We're looking at a second down, flags down. This play never going to get off the ground. And all of a sudden, from second and manageable, it's going to go to second and long.
Snap infraction. Offense. It's a 5-yard penalty. Second down.
First penalty on the Red Hawks. That's the center, the third team All-MAC. Danny Gunlewski making his 36th start for the Red Hawks.
Both of these offenses are shooting themselves in the foot when things are looking good, right? It's either a penalty, it's a, you know, it's a negative play off of a reverse, it's a sack. When everything is rolling, something negative is happening. These guys got to stay out of these negative plays.
Straight ahead goes Shelton, and he breaks free and trips at the 42-yard line. He was on his way.
This is exactly what we were talking about early in the game. They've got to run downhill. Don't worry about trying to run it side to side. Don't worry about the jet sweeps. Don't worry about any of the pullers outside and trying to get on the perimeter that way. Hit it right downhill between the tackles. This is where Miami makes the game nasty, and they love this type of physicality, and this is what they've won with.
26 yards on that gain by Shelton, who had 148 earlier this year in a conference game against the Golden Flashes of Kent State. Gabbert, short drop, comes up firing, caught. 32-yard line, one more grab for Jack Sorensen. Five targets, five catches. That's the only guy Gabbert has thrown the ball to successfully so far.
Yeah, and I like his accuracy. Right now he's 5 for 6. He's very accurate. His timing is great. His decision-making's great. He's not even hesitating, Dave. He knows that he's got the speed cut out. He's going to throw it. And again, coming off the goal line, he threw it three times earlier. They're very confident in what he's able to do tonight.
Sorensen now 39 catches on the season. Second down and a couple for Miami. Gabbert in trouble. He'll have a first down, and he knows what to do. He gets the first down, I believe. Yep, they move the chains on that one. His brothers are here. They're keeping an eye on him. He gets a lot of support from them, as you might guess.
I think Blaine would be happy that he slid on that day. What do you
think? I know Brett is. There's no doubt about that. He knew what to do. He knew where that marker was.
Well, he did. You know, and again, that's just that kind of football acumen that you have, right? He grew up around it. He knew he had the first down. Don't take the big hit. Get down and live for another down.
He's in some trouble here and cannot get loose. Hurled down by Joe Dillon. 7.5 sacks for Dillon on the season. That's a loss of 8.
Yeah, Joe Dillon is the guy. And you know what? This is a great deal for this kid. He missed all last year with an injury. And he's the number one guy when it comes to negative plays on this team. He is their sack leader. And again, when they look for a big play, they're looking for it coming from Joe Dillon.
Yeah, his 9th tackle for a loss, Richard Jr. out of Tylertown, Mississippi. So all of a sudden, that's the 2nd sack for Louisiana, 32 on the season. And it's 2nd down and 18. Diving grab made, and I believe that's somebody other than Sorensen. It is. The catch made by James May. Sooners, Buckeyes, and a couple of Tigers with one goal, the national championship. In episode 2, Dabo Swinney motivates his team during the CFP semifinal game against Ohio State inside the college football playoff. Episode 2 now streaming on ESPN Plus exclusively. 3rd down and 11 coming up.
I don't think you're going to see them have to go for it all. They've got a great field goal kicker. They're going to look to the sideline, see what the best play is to get to. If they move it 5, 6, 7 yards, they're going to be in range for their field goal kicker.
You're going to go again. I think that's a first down. A long throw right at the marker. That should be caught at the 20-yard line by Jalen Walker, and that will be a first down.
Again, I love the decision-making of Brett Gabbert. He's not going to take chances. The corner plays off, and he has the comeback on the boundary right there, and he sticks it right where he needs to stick it. Gets a huge first down, keeps the chains alive. And again, they don't need to go for a field goal, but they were going to be good with it because they love their field goal kicker, one of the best in the country in Sam Sloan.
High snap to the ground goes Jalen Bester. Bester inside the 15. Somebody's helmet is rolled off, so that player will have to sit out of play. That's a solid 5-yard pickup. Second down and 5. And that was Jones who lost his hat. Andre Jones. Shelton is back into the tailback. He had a big run to get this drive juiced. He stays in the block this time. Gabbert's going to take off. Makes one cut. And he'll be short of the first down. Here comes a penalty marker. Couple of them.
Looks like it's going to be a face mask.
Lorenzo McCaskill, number 2, may have been the guilty one. We're still waiting on the officials to make it official. I'm kind of with you on this one, Gene. I think that's what it's going to be, but
I don't think there's any question.
Personal foul, face mask, defense number 17. Penalty when forced half the distance to the goal line. Includes an automatic first down.
That was Manak actually caught with it, so the Red Hawks will move a little further down the field. I think it's actually number 2, as we just showed you. So we were right up here, was McCaskill, not number 17. Either way, bottom line, first and goal from the 5. To the ground. And very close goes Jalen Bester. He is in. Touchdown, Miami Redhawks.
I love the physicality of this Miami team right now. Up front, those 5 big guys up front, they're saying bring it on. Tailbacks are running downhill. Doesn't matter whether it's Bester who scores this one or Shelton who's had some big plays. These guys are saying, you know what? We're going to make this a physical mother tonight, and we're going to come straight downhill at you. And right now, they are definitely winning the physicality battle in this game, though.
Miami has scored first in each of their last 6 games. They've won 5 of them. And they're now 13-13 with 8 touchdowns in the red zone in their last 5 games. They run this one, 9 plays, 61 yards in 4.5 minutes. And the aforementioned Sam Sloman is honest with the PAT. Miami has had a lead in every game this season. Yes, even the Ohio State game. And they lead the Lending Tree Bowl in the second quarter. A week from tonight at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ESPN and the ESPN app, we'll have the college football playoff national title game presented by AT&T at the Mercedes-Benz Superdome in New Orleans. Heisman winner Joe Burrow and number 1 LSU taking on Trevor Lawrence and number 3 Clemson. I know, Gene, you'll be there, part of the SEC network crew. How do you see this battle between these two titanic foes?
Tune in. Who knows?
I don't know. I mean,
I tell you, man, you sit there on one side and you say, how does anybody stop LSU? And then you sit there and you look at what Brett Venables done on defense with Clemson and say, man, you give that guy 2 weeks to prepare, be careful.
I tell you what, his defense's ability to force Ohio State to kick field goals won that game for them ultimately, I thought. But Ohio State gets those 7s instead of 3s.
It's probably done. Over. Yeah, it's probably over.
So what is the issue here with Louisiana's offense, Gene? And we talked about how explosive they are. Yes, Miami has been very good in the first quarter defensively lately, but what's missing?
I don't think they're who they are right now. You know, you go back and you look, they came off the goal line last time. They had a great call on the bootleg. Then they ran the ball up the middle for a few good yards. But all of a sudden you get a double reverse, right? That's not who they are. It's pound the football, wear the guys out up front. You got 3 tailbacks. They got to get back to this.
And they come out throwing. LeBlanc makes the catch right away. He was in a pile in the backfield. And it says healthy game, though, on first down of 7. It's interesting. Their first down plays have been excellent. It's been everything else that's been a problem for them.
Yeah, coming into this drive right now, they've been averaging 12 yards on first downs. And then they find a way to get into a negative situation. Dave, we've mentioned the double reverse. I've seen a couple of illegal procedures. You're looking at just finding ways. They took a sack, finding ways to get negative plays, and they got to stay out of those. First down's been great.
And again, it's about the same play, but that time the pass was too long and too low for Peter LeBlanc, the freshman from New Iberia, Louisiana. So it'll be third down and a manageable 2, maybe 3 yards.
I wouldn't be surprised, again, if you look and watch them bring the tight end back close to the core and run the football, get back to who they are. It's 3rd and 2. Make a statement.
Lewis, will he run it? No, he'll throw it. And a fine catch made there by Bradley. And Bradley will get it to right around midfield, maybe even a little bit into Miami territory, gain of 18.
I like the play. It's a bootleg. Same one they ran coming off the goal line a little while ago. Jamarcus Bradley did a great job on the over route. Great catch. Nice finish to the play. That was a really good play call on 3rd and 2. I would have thought they were going to run the football, which is why you saw Miami turn a guy free on the over route.
Well, Louisiana has only 14 rush yards on 8 attempts. Make it 9 attempts. Lewis, he may have to scramble here. He'll throw it in away. Very intelligent play there by the junior from Baton Rouge. It'll be 2nd and 10. Let me do my math again, Gene. 4, 5, 8 rushing attempts. Either way, only 14 rush yards for Louisiana, and that may be why there's a 0 in their scoring column.
Well, one thing I will say is that there's a lot of situations in here as I look at this Miami defense where they're saying, throw the ball to beat me. They're putting 9 guys up near the line of scrimmage. You can't be so confident in your run game that you think you can block 9. You can't. So that's why you're seeing a little bit more passing than probably anticipated coming into the game.
Well, they went empty, and we're going to have flags. Now, we saw Doug Costin, number 58.
Snap infraction. Offense, number 64. It's a 5-yard penalty. 2nd down.
It's interesting. 58 for Miami, Doug Costin, who is a terrific football player, got up and started pointing right away, and the officials threw the flag. And they're going to say that Shane Vallo committed a snap infraction. That's 5 penalties on UL. And now look at 2nd down and 15. And here's another self-inflicted wound on offense.
Yeah, it's very frustrating to the coach right now when you've got plays called. They were in a rhythm again, and here comes the negative plays. They've got to get out of this. This is a bad deal.
Lewis in some trouble from Costin. He gets the pass off, and an immediate open field tackle made on the receiver, Calais. And a great hit by Mike Brown, the junior from Grand Rapids. A gain of only 4. It's 3rd and 11.
Thought that was a great job by Miami playing some zone coverage where they could get eyes on the quarterback, eyes on the ball, breaking on the football. Mike Brown did a great job of bringing it down. They're really good at limiting yards after the catch.
Flags down here. Might be an offside. Lewis will throw. Oh, a fine catch made inside the 20, inside the 15 by Gossett. Let's see if this is an offside. Indeed, everybody's heading down the field as if this play is going to count. What a throw and catch.
There's no question it's going to count. I love the call.
Defense number 49.
He drew
that penalty
was a free play.
Result of the play is a 1st down.
He knew it was a free play. He threw the ball up. Again, this was a design deal. We're going to get him to draw. We're going to draw him off sides. Watch the offensive line. They never moved. They got their one-on-one shot down the field with Gossett. Let's throw it up on a 5-11 corner right now when you're 6-6.
Gossett from nearby Pensacola. Regis is the tailback now. Best position for Louisiana offensively so far. Short game for the redshirt junior out of New Orleans of 1 or 2 following that 38-yard hookup. Miles Reed in there on the stop for the Redhawks. 8 minutes remaining in this game. Miami with the 1 touchdown on the board. It was 0-0 at the end of the first quarter. Oh, flipper here to Calais, who we talked about his great speed, trying to get him outside, but Miami is well prepared for this. Spencer Nowitzki, John House, the defense coordinator, Chuck Martin, of course, active with the defense. That's another short game. It'll be third down. Yeah, they're going to need about six, almost seven.
Well, Weatherford, number 21, the safety, he's all over the field. They do a great job at Miami of setting the edges to the defense. That was a great job. This is going to be important right here. They need a red zone touchdown. They're 69% touchdowns in the red zone coming into this game.
Whoa, that is one of the more blatant false starts in the history of college football.
Offense, number 29, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Do we say it again, Dave?
Please go ahead, your turn.
Self-inflicted wound.
You know, next time we'll get Lauren to say it, and that way we all
said it. But that's the sixth one.
That's
six.
Wow.
We're not at halftime yet. This is just, and when they're pre-snap penalties, that's what drives head coaches nuts. You know, you're good with try-hard penalties. Pre-snap and post-snap, that's just a lack of focus.
So it's third down and a dozen. Little lob, and the receiver got completely turned around. I'm not sure what happened with Jamarcus Bradley. He was looking for one thing. Levi Lewis was looking for another. Bottom line, it's 4th and 12.
Yeah, I thought it was great coverage. And you got a safety over the top. Watch a corner. Does a great job putting the hands on guys. And 21, Weatherford, he's all over the field. He had that over the top. That was a really good defensive finish by Miami.
So Steve Arteague has missed two of his last three. At one point during the year, he had 12 in a row nailed down, a redshirt senior from Lafayette. From 33 yards out, Bam Jackson the holder, Paul Boudreaux will snap it. And the raging Cajuns are on the board on Arteague and the 33-yard field goal. But Chuck Martin is delighted at 7-3.
The Lending Tree Bowl, brought to you by Lending Tree. Shop and compare loans, credit cards, insurance, and more.
Oh, the history of the Lending Tree Bowl. You saw Byron Leftwich and Marshall Agee with ECU. They both scored 60 points. You saw Ben Roethlisberger. This is where his last college football game was. And Tulsa put up 63 on Bowling Green, the largest margin of victory in the history of this bowl. And a fine crowd has showed up here. Strong support from both fan bases, from Oxford and from Lafayette. And, of course, the city of Mobile enjoys this event as well. You take a look at Stevie Arteague there. He is now the number two all-time scorer in Ragin' Cajun's football history after that made field goal. And he's handling kickoff duties, which he normally does not do. Short one. Look out here. This is Thomas. Well, they're ready for him, and you have to be. You factor that guy in and his ability to return kicks. So Brett Gabbert, it's been a while since we've seen him play a little football. It's going to be a little bit while longer, but we'll see him. Yeah, let's take a look back on our great Clips drive recap.
Well, it started out, it was a 9-play, 61-yard drive. Here you see Tyrese Shelton, 26-yard gain first. That kind of got things rolling, and I like the accuracy of Gabbert. He's thrown the ball. It's been great timing. Sorensen's been a great target for him. And look, finishing it off with a touchdown run. Tough touchdown run by Bester. Very physical down there at the goal line. And I like where Miami's playing the game tonight.
Davion Johnson is a tailback now. Yeah, Tyrese Shelton had a big run on that drive. Gabbert, some great throws. A little swing pass and a catch behind the line of scrimmage. Shelton was the receiver, but he didn't get very far that time as Tariq Miller out of Pensacola stuffed that one for a loss of three.
Yeah, that's a great open field tackle, too, and those tackles aren't easy. They look easy on TV. On the field, they're not easy. Again, he got him by the shoestring, but bringing a guy down in the open field, no matter how you get him down, that's the name of the game.
High snap to the ground, and this is going to be more trouble here as Bester wrestled to the ground by Joe Dillon, the TFL expert for Louisiana. That's going to be a loss of one. It's going to be third and long.
Joe Dillon is a disciplined football player. That's the bottom line. He stays where he's supposed to be. As you mentioned, Dave, king of negative plays, right? Tackle for loss and sacks. Joe Dillon shows up.
Now, Miami and the National, you see Louisiana's defense so much better this year. Ron Roberts, the coordinator, former head coach, has done wonders with this Raging Cajun group. He has given up 5 first downs. In the MAC championship game, the Redhawks had 2 first downs in the entire first half and would go on to win. Gabbert, little tunnel screen to Sorensen, picked it off the shoot-tops and got nothing, maybe a yard. Ran into several Louisiana defenders led by Percy Butler, the free safety, and this was a rough drive for the Redhawks. It's fourth down.
Yeah, they ended up going backwards. Kyle Kramer's going to have to get him out of the hole, but if you got to have a punter to do it, that's the guy. He averages over 43 yards per punt, and they've got great coverage units. Again, this is how Miami wins games. They don't prefer to be in a fourth and 13, but if you are, you got a great punter to get you out of that bind. But,
and you've got Guerrero, who averages about 5 yards a pop on returns, standing at the 35. Good look kick. But Guerrero's got a little room here. If he can avoid one man, he did. Guerrero goes up the gut, gets hit at the 40, and fights forward to the 43-yard line. That's a very nice 11-yard return, and by far the best field position for the Raging Cajuns in this Lending Tree Bowl. We very much look forward to that. Gene, I want a word from you about Tua. We were there. We listened to the announcement ourselves, but let's get this play out of the way first on first down and 10. And it's going to be Lewis for the play action fake, stepping up, long throw, 1v1, and wow, Sterling Weatherford, what a tackle that was. I do want to ask you, Gene, for a comment about Tua's decision today.
Yeah, I don't think it surprised a lot of people. I mean, I think there was speculation because they were holding the press conference that maybe, just maybe, because Tua's a different guy. He thinks a little bit differently than everybody else. It was a family decision. I know it wasn't just his, but he had to do what was best for him, Dave. I think in the end, when you know you're going to be a top 15 pick, he'll probably go 4 or 5. They're saying the Dolphins love him, and it's hard to turn down that money. When we had Cam and he knew he was going to be the first pick, you think for a second I thought he was coming back? I think not.
He did okay for you that one year, though. Yeah, that's what I've heard. Oh, Lewis. Wow. What a terrific throw. Jalen Williams with a grab. Is he inbound? Looks like it. Weatherford on the coverage. Wow, what a throw this is.
Boy, he put it right in there. They ran a corner route, and he put it right in front of the safety and right behind the corner, which is really the only window you could put it in. That's why they love Levi Lewis. Very efficient, good decision maker, nice finish.
And Miami's got to call a timeout or face a penalty here. Let's see. Oh, they got away with having 12 on the field. They were. Chuck Martin was going to call for a timeout. Lewis, run pass option. And Miami will keep this to a short gain on the catch by Jamarcus Bradley. A gain of a couple. It'll be second down as we're under 3 minutes before we get to halftime. Earlier, we showed you a number that Louisiana's way better this season when leading at halftime than when not. They haven't won a game this season when trailing at the half. 0-3. They haven't lost a game. This is the winningest season in Louisiana football history at 10 victories, 11. We'll just add a lot of extra pecans on the bread pudding. Lewis in some trouble. He's got room to run. Gets a key block downfield. First down. And that block came from Raymond Calais, the running back. Miles Reed flushed him out. Ben Kipler chased him, but you knew Levi Lewis would outrun them.
Yeah, he did the right thing. There was nobody open down the field. That's what's made him what he is. Very good decision maker. He's got good athletic ability. Can run the football.
Game 12 there. To the ground they go to Mitchell. Mitchell to the 10. Mitchell bouncing off defenders, gets inside the 5-yard line, down to the 4. Under 2 minutes as the clock stops with 1:57 to go. Brown saves the touchdown.
This looks like raging Cajun football, right? Get it downhill, run the split zone, let Mitchell find the crease. Nice job finishing the run.
Quickly back to live action and quickly up the gut. And down to the 2-yard line goes Mitchell. Girardi in there.
You're starting to see who they are, right? Yep. They're guys that get up to the line of scrimmage. They run the football. This is when they're most successful. You know what hasn't happened in this drive, Dave? No negative plays.
No penalties.
No negative plays. And again, when they're hitting on those cylinders, or they can get in the sink running the ball, this is who Louisiana is.
They ran this season, in a regular season, for 3,499 yards, fifth best in the country. They averaged over 6 yards a run. Before this drive, they were averaging barely 3 yards a run. Timeout called by the Redhawks with 1:09 to go. So they have 2 timeouts remaining. And by the way, Billy Napier has 3 timeouts. So he's in a great position, second and goal. And there you see the numbers we talked about. Unbelievable. Number 9 in the nation in total offense. Those 41 rushing touchdowns, Navy and Army had more, and so did Clemson. And that was it.
Yeah.
That's it.
I mean, if you want to go to yards per attempt,
yeah,
which is extremely important, they're number 2 in the country. The only person, or the only team out there that has a better rush per attempt is Clemson.
Yeah, that's unbelievable.
These guys run the football. And look, let's go one step further. Before this drive, they had more penalty yards than they had rush yards.
Absolutely right.
And now all of a sudden they're back up to 62. They're getting a little bit more into the groove. And look, you know, in every win they've had this season, they've rushed for a minimum of 225 yards, Dave. And now you're starting to see this offensive line kind of take over and the running backs hit it downhill. And I would expect they're going to finish this drive with that mentality.
Second and goal from the 2. Elijah Mitchell, Billy Napier said, might be the best player on the team. Stays in. Power package here. Mitchell lowers the shoulders and fights his way in the end zone. Touchdown, Louisiana. They take the lead.
They bring in big people. They bring in extra tight ends. They say, you're going to run it right down your throat. We're going to run it between the tackles. We got a 220-pound tailback who's going to put his head down and drive this pile. Reaches over, scores. This is who Louisiana is, and this is who they've been all year.
They go back to the big scramble by Lewis when he was in trouble, worked his way out of it, gained a dozen, kept the drive alive. But on that, 57 yards, 7 plays in 3 minutes and a couple of seconds, and 35 of those were rush yards. And it's 10-7, Raging Cajuns. Take a look at our Bowl Challenge Cup standings brought to you by Progressive. And the SEC on top, they got one more.
They
the
do.
SEC. Mountain West, Pac-12, the American Conference, the Sun Belt. You see sort of in the middle, so we're going to break a tie between the Mid-American Conference and the Sun Belt. But in the last 4 years, the Sun Belt's had the highest percentage of any conference in winning bowl games.
I think the Sun Belt is one of those conferences that have those kind of teams in there. If you're in the Power Five, there's a bunch of teams you don't want to play. I can tell you.
One of them, Appalachian State, certainly comes to mind as the conference champions. And if you watch that conference championship game, Appalachian State playing at home jumped all over Louisiana, up by 21 in the first half, and the Raging Cajuns roared back and ended up being a one-score game before Appalachian State prevailed. By the way, that's the 42nd rush touchdown for Louisiana. That's the school record. They just continue to rewrite. Here's a big moment, because you do have a great returner in Thomas. Will he get a chance? No. Tomorrow night on ESPN and the ESPN app, we will have a Big Ten SEC college basketball doubleheader for you. Number 5 Ohio State takes on number 15 Maryland in a Sonic blockbuster at 7 Eastern. Then John Calipari and number 17 Kentucky squares off against Georgia, but they got to do it in Athens. Well, a minute five to go. We'll see what Chuck Martin's approach is on the offensive end with his coordinators. Eric Kohler is the play caller. And we'll just see. Last time out, Miami went backwards.
One thing they won't do is put the ball in harm's way down here. He's a conservative play caller. He knows that going into halftime with this close score does not bother him.
What a hit on Bester. Boy, that was solidly delivered. You had Ferrico Gardner there, Farad Gardner, pardon me. Man, that was a pop.
Yeah, you know, this Louisiana defense now, they can run side to side. This is why Miami coming into the game, their game plan was to run downhill with these guys. Gardner's a guy that can bring it on the outside. They set edges really well on the defense. And again, I'd suspect you're going to see Miami, if they're going to run it, they're going to continue to try to pound it up inside the guards, inside the tackles. That's where they've been really having the most success.
So Louisiana had three timeouts, and after that three-yard gain, and a hard-earned three-yard gain, they stopped the clock with 57 seconds to go.
This is where you got to love the strategy of the game on both sides, right? What are both sides thinking right now? Billy's thinking, if I can get the ball back one more time, maybe I can hit a field goal here late. You know, look, Chuck Martin's okay with going in with a 10-7 halftime score. He has no problem with that. That's how they win games, right? Keep it to a one-score game.
You're right.
So he has no problem with this.
To the ground, Bester. You see, Gardner got him again, but this time Bester fought that off. They're marking him just shy of the first down.
I think you're going to see a rinse and repeat. Here we go again. They're going to run it again inside the guards.
Well, the other thing I'm noticing, Gene, it seems like Louisiana is accepting Miami's offer to run the clock out after, because that was a successful play. So it looks like neither coach, let's say they're putting a few cards in their pockets right now.
Yeah. This is how Miami's won games, right? Don't put the ball in jeopardy. Don't worry about it. 10-7 game at halftime is no big deal. One score games, we can win it. Let's just not beat ourselves.
Yep, we're going to get a timeout call now by Miami with 9 seconds left. Well, Saturday at noon Eastern, ABC and the ESPN app, we will have the FCS championship game between 15-0 number one North Dakota State and number two James Madison at Toyota Stadium in Frisco, Texas. The Bison are the defending champs, and have won an FCS record 36 in a row, including the title 7 of the last 8 years. The year they didn't win, James Madison did. The Dukes have been in championship game 3 of the last 4 years.
Let's talk about two teams that nobody in the FBS wants to play.
Yeah,
either one of them.
Yeah, I don't think the phone rings very much in the offseason.
Hey, man, when you get and some of those FCS schools, they play some great football. Absolutely.
Yeah.
They will. They've got some really good players. They have less scholarships. They can challenge you on any given day. I've seen it. People have seen it over the years. But watch that football game. I'm going to put in a plug for that level of football because I think it's great football. That's two really good football teams between James Madison and North Dakota State.
They put 1 second back on the clock. We've got 10 remaining. Third down and inches. To the ground. First down. That will temporarily stop the clock. A lot of pad popping going on. 4 seconds left. Might be the last play of the half. And based on the fact that it looks like Chuck Martin is walking off the field, I think it's going to be halftime. Well, Gina said it. Miami wants to keep the games close, and they have achieved that. Louisiana has achieved something else. They're 10-0 when they take a lead into the dressing room at halftime, and that's exactly what they're about to do. And they will get the football first to start the second half. So you've got a few trends. One of them's going to get busted here. Standing by, Lauren is with Billy Napier.
Coach, you guys had a lot of self-inflicted wounds there in the first half. How critical will it be to clean that up for the second half here?
Yeah, you got to have a little more poise. We've settled down. We've started to compete. You know, I think been off for a month, a little rusty. So good thing is we played the end of the half well. We get the ball coming back out.
How do you reestablish your offensive identity that we saw there on that last drive from you guys?
Well, we got a lot of hats in there, you know. I think we'll make adjustments. We've done it all year. We're looking forward to finishing the second half.
Thanks so much, Coach.
All right, thank you.
Lauren and Coach, thank you very much. It is time for Kevin Connors and Trevor Manich, who will take over for halftime after the break.
Welcome back to Capital One Bowl Mania.
And we welcome you back to the Lending Tree Bowl as part of, and actually the end of, Capital One Bowl Mania. Save, of course, for the national championship game a week from tonight with Gene Chizik, Dave Lamont, Lauren Sisler patrolling the sidelines, 10-7 Louisiana. And yes, they have the lead, Gene, but it's been an uncharacteristic performance for the Raging Cajuns so far on offense.
Yeah, I think anytime you look at a 60-yard rushing performance at halftime for Louisiana, you'd be shocked, right? But there's a couple of reasons. One, Miami's putting a lot of hats around the ball. You can't sit there and beat your head against the wall trying to run against 8 and 9 man fronts. What do you have to do? You have to loosen it up a little bit. You have to kick the ball out to the perimeter, throw some of those spot screens, take a couple of shots down the field. And then sometimes, Dave, when there is 8 guys in there, you just got to be tougher and you have to run the ball against it. So we'll see what their plan is. They do a great job of adjusting at halftime to what the defenses are doing. We're going to see what happens.
And this is a typical touchback. There's also a penalty marker down at the 41-yard line. So hold everything.
Offside, kicking team number 52. That 5-yard penalty will be added to the touchback spot. First down.
It'll be all, ball will be at the 30-yard line. Let's check into the sidelines. Lauren Sisler.
I'll tell you what, guys. This game is a bit indicative of what Miami faced against Central Michigan in the MAC championship game, down 4 points at the half. And Coach said he likes the way this offense is performing. He likes the poise from his quarterback. He sees these guys coming out here moving the football well. We just have to keep fighting, is what he said. Play our best to have a chance here. We need a stop, and we have to score. The pressure is on us now.
Very interesting. That is an interesting way of looking at this game. And the Raging Cajuns come out with a handoff. A pickup, solid 4 yards for Elijah Mitchell, who has the touchdown on the board for Louisiana in this Lending Tree Bowl. Second down and 6 coming up.
I think you're going to see a lot of tempo here. Again, I think they're going to get try to get back to who they've been. They're going to snap the ball quick.
The long throw, tackle broken there by Bradley. Bradley will get a first down. He'll get just shy of midfield before a few Redhawks tacklers bring him down after a 14-yard pickup.
That's a great example of them loading the box. There's too many people around the football. What does he do? He kicks the ball out to a spot screen. And when you do that, let Jamarcus Bradley do all the work.
And back to the ground we go. And into Redhawks territory goes Mitchell. And he'll get to the 44-yard line, 2 yards shy of the first down.
Love the tempo, love the strategy. They talked about it at halftime. What are we going to do to come out and get this defense on their heels? Tempo right now is what's doing it.
They sent Jackson in motion one way, back to Mitchell. He'll have the first down, I think. It's real close, and yep, they are indeed waving the chains to be moved. Ben Kimpler playing his 36th game for Miami, and they're on the stop.
Now, the 4 possessions that they had in the first half, Louisiana only had 4 possessions. On the only possession where they did not have a negative play or penalty, they scored a touchdown. The other 3, not so much.
Is that a product of the time off?
Possibly.
Fake to Mitchell. Lewis wants the deep shot, instead goes for the intermediate route instead, and it pays off. A solid catch by Jalen Williams. He got belted hard, but hangs on. That's a 20-yard pickup.
I love the call. It was a boot, and they brought him from the other side of the field. Great job on a wheel route coming from the other side of the field. Nice, efficient throw, easy throw. Lewis just set his feet, delivered the ball, and it was a nice touch, nice finish on the play.
Dre Regas is the tailback now for the Raging Cajuns. Play action fake, Lewis on the run, has his man, that's Jackson. And Jackson is hip checked out of bounds at around the 15-yard line. Brown on the stop. So that is a solid 7-yard pickup.
Garrett, watch the tempo.
I'm just watching the chunks of yards, and we have a Miami player injured. And that's Barati, the senior from Spring, Texas, who's shaken up at the 13-yard line. First time we have seen the athletic training staffs have to come out today. Levi Lewis has now passed 3,000 yards this season in the air for Louisiana. Timeout on the field.
Stream your favorite sports, stories, and series with ESPN Plus, Disney Plus, and Hulu. Get all three for just $12.99 a month.
The third quarter has been a friend for Louisiana this evening, this season, I should say. 123-51, they have outscored their opponents in that third quarter, and they're driving now. Fifth play of the drive coming up, and they've already gone 55 yards. They lead 10-7 here in the Lending Tree Bowl. It's Regis on the handoff. Another first down for the Raging Cajuns. First and goal.
That's another example where I was talking earlier, Dave, about the fact that sometimes when you got eight hats in there, you got to run it anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And you got to run for the tough yards, the dirty yards. That's what you just saw.
Happy to report that Barbarotti is back in. Lauren checked in with us from the sidelines that he was just being treated for cramps. Regis. And Barati is among the tacklers there. That's a solid 5-yard pickup, though. This has been a dominating drive so far by Louisiana.
Well, you wonder why they're outscoring everybody in the third quarter like they've done all year. It's because they do make really good halftime adjustments. This is a coaching staff that knows exactly what they're doing. They know exactly what they're looking for. And they're good in the country as adjusting to their second half.
Odd little power set to the right they go with this time. And we have whistles before the play. They really went with an odd, unbalanced look on
full
that right side.
Offense, number 75. It's a 5-yard penalty, second down.
Yeah, what they did is they went to Wildcat. They put Regis at tailback as the Wildcat quarterback. Again, what did we say, though? What has thwarted all of these drives? Penalties, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Penalties, they're on a roll. They get to, you know, look. And right now, Chuck's saying, let's hold them to a field goal.
Five false starts by Louisiana so far. So let's see what they do. Lewis is going to take this snap. Turns, fakes to Regis. Pressure coming from the edge. Lewis stays alive. Throws toward the end zone. Wide open. Touchdown. Raging Cajuns. The catch by Jamarcus Bradley.
It's not surprising that Bradley is the recipient of this. He's had 21 touchdown catches coming into this game. Look, the record in Louisiana is 25 by Brandon Stokely.
Oh,
he's getting close.
His ninth of the season. What a dominating 70-yard drive this was, taking up 4 minutes and 9 seconds. Also, a new school record, a new standard of 26 touchdown passes for the Raging Cajuns this season. It has been the finest year in Louisiana football history. It may get even finer if they can maintain their lead here in Mobile.
The Lending Tree Bowl, brought to you by Great Clips. It's gonna be great. And Capital One, what's in your wallet?
Absolutely ideal football weather in the 50s here in Mobile, Alabama. Time for our PlayStation Player Impact Rating. Jamarcus Bradley of Louisiana is one of 7 wide receivers this year in FBS with a PIR of 90 or better. And when targeted, Bradley is averaging 15.4 yards per reception. The rest of the Louisiana wideouts, 11.5. And Louisiana's quarterbacks are averaging a 94 QBR when targeting Bradley, 10 points higher than when targeting everyone else. And who just scored in the touchdown? Big crisis here for Miami. We'll see how the Red Hawks respond. Thomas, this is a good way to get things going for Miami, but Louisiana is on him. Both teams excellent in the special teams. and he only gets out to about the 20. We want to remind you about Saturday at noon Eastern on ABC and the ESPN app. We'll have the FCS championship game between 15-0, number one North Dakota State, and number two James Madison at Toyota Stadium in Frisco, Texas. The Bison are the defending champs and have won an FCS record 36 straight, including the title in 7 of the last 8 years. And when they didn't win it, James Madison did. The Dukes have been in the title game 3 of the last 4. Jalen Bester in the backfield for the freshman Brett Gabbard is going to throw on first down. A long throw, catch, 32-yard line made by Cam Blakely. And Blakely gets a first down for the Red Hawks at the 36.
I like the game plan of Miami. With the corners playing off, they're going to take advantage of the off corner. They have confidence in Gabbard that he can throw even from the far hash. And they're really doing a good job with that, moving the chains. Gabbard has been excellent tonight in terms of completion percentage.
Going to keep it here. Once Sorensen, he got him, and that's another first down. He was well covered. They're fighting for that football in the pile. Louisiana says it belongs to them. I'm waiting on the officials to say either down or a turnover.
It'll be a first down.
There you go. Jaquet was in on the initial hit. So it's first and 10, Red Hawks at the 49-yard line. We will see if the communicator buzzes down to the referee or not for a booth replay. They've already had a chance to look at it. Gabbard again. Gets his man Walker. And wow, from Louisiana. Absolutely hitting that time. Tariq Miller in there. Andre Jones in there. It's a gain of 3, 2nd and 7.
Yeah, they're staying true to what the game plan is. Corners playing off. Again, let's take advantage of it. No, it was only a 3-yard gain, but that means that there was a lot of people stacked in the box. They don't want to try to continue to run it into 8- and 9-man boxes. They're going to get the ball on a soft corner. You will continue. I mean, you're going to continue to see him take advantage of that as we go.
Fake to Bester, who stays in the block. Gabbard got on base, fires Sorensen again with a catch, and he is belted at the 30-yard line, but Lee is having a big game. Jacques Boudreau, he hits you, you know it, but it's a first down.
I like Brent Gabbard's accuracy right now. Guys, he's 13 for 14 in this game. He is on fire. He's accurate. He's making quick decisions. I love the way he's getting protected right now. Sometimes you're only throwing 3-man routes, but it doesn't matter. Guys are getting open.
Shelton has moved into the tailback spot. It's going to be Gabbard on the keep, and he will fight to the 26, almost the 25-yard line. That's about a 5-yard pickup for that by Jaquet. It's been Jack Sorensen's day. That's the first half. He was the recipient of the first 4 completions.
Yeah, well, he's just really continued on from his last game that he played in the MAC championship, where he had 8 catches for 123 yards. He's his go-to guy. Let's keep in mind, Dave, we talked to the coaches yesterday about he's only playing at 80% right now. This guy's playing with a hurt foot, and look, there's no way to get it healed unless you rest him. But right now he's not playing like there's anything wrong with his foot.
Gabbard now 5 for 5 on the drive, but Sorensen, a beautiful tackle executed by Tariq Miller. So Gabbard may be 5 out of 5. It's going to be 3rd and 4.
Yeah, Tariq Miller's a 5th-year senior. He's kind of seen it all. He does a great job of breaking outside in on the ball. But look at the open field tackle. The only thing I would say, hey, big boy, keep your head up. Keep your eyes up when you make that tackle. Great open field tackle. Nice finish.
Gabbard wants his man underneath. He's got him. And that's Andrew Homer, the tight end, with his first reception. And he has a first down after a gain of 6.
Yeah, the play calling, I really like the play calling. So you're looking at boots. You're looking at play actions. You're looking at easy access throws when the corners are setting off. To be honest with you, he's just picking and choosing on this drive. It's dealer's choice. They're doing a great job calling it. But let's be honest, the guy throwing it right now, he's pretty much on fire.
11 consecutive completions. Davion Johnson takes over at the tailbot. Right now, it's been all Gabbert. This time they'll dump it off, and Louisiana has read it. And that was diagnosed by Farrad Gardner, and he just tossed Jalen Walker to the turf for a loss, and a big loss, back to the 25.
What we do know in this game for both sides is anytime you end up with a negative play, it's a momentum breaker. It stalls these drives. It puts you in a really bad second and 17 scenario. Again, I'd be looking for some sort of screens and draws. If they do get an easy access throw, which Louisiana is not giving them now, you can look for that. But I'd be looking for the screens and draw again.
They're going to go to the ground here. Besker, and he just sort of disappears in that pile. It's going to be third down and about 13 to go here.
Let's be mindful also on this drive, Dave. Sam Sloman, who we have not seen, the field goal kicker, he's the best in the business right now. If they get the ball to about the 35, they feel very good about him kicking a field goal. So they don't have to strain right here. They want 7, but 13 is a tough prospect. We're going to see what they play call on this, but they got a field goal kicker to get it out of the jam.
And will Louisiana heat up the pocket a little bit or play coverage? They rush 4. Gabbert has time. Makes a long throw, and it's overthrown. It'll be fourth down, and immediately the holder, Kyle Kramer, leads him out for the outstanding place kicker, Sam Sloman. That ends. Gabbert had a great run of completions in a row. 12 straight before that one went awry. Sloman, 14 out of 15, under 40 yards. 25 out of 29 on the year. This one from 39. Low snap.
It's automatic.
This guy's going to get drafted, isn't he, Gene?
He's got a chance. They don't draft many kickers, but this one would have a chance.
The College Football Playoff National Championship Game. Number 1 LSU, number 3 Clemson, January 13th at 8 on ESPN.
So 5:18 remaining, that 58-yard drive, 11 plays, and the Sloman 39-yard field goal cuts the Raging Cajuns lead to 17-10. With Gene Chizik, I'm Dave Lamont. We'll hear from Lawrence Sisler in a moment on the field, and a beautiful evening here in Mobile, and here we go with Sloman. This one's going to be returnable. This is highly unusual. Calais at about the 4-yard line. Well, you could see absolutely uninterrupted and unblocked. Miami had this one defended absolutely beautifully. And let's check in with Lauren Sisler.
Yeah, guys, after that last Louisiana touchdown, Chuck Martin came over to the secondary bench. He said, we have to execute our defense. Our offense will score. We have to get stops. Just do your jobs. It's only the third quarter. Let's go. We're fine. I'm sensing a lot of confidence down here from Chuck Martin, guys.
That's because, Lauren, it's a close game. This is what Miami has done most of the season. Once they started conference play, and they had to rebound from getting waxed by the Buckeyes and beat a good Buffalo team to start conference play. And that's when Chuck Martin knew he might have a special season. Lewis. He'll take off. Oh, look at him go. Look at Lewis go! And he's outside the 35. They're going to say he was down at the 34-yard line where he first made contact with the ground and gained 13.
Well, this is the advantage of having an athletic quarterback, right? They have a boot. He made a great decision. Everything was covered. Pull the ball down, run it, get all those yards. Great job on the decision making.
And now Mitchell goes bouncing off tackle, and he will pick up at 3 yards there, second down and 7. Now, Levi Lewis, leading vote getter for team captain. You may have noticed that C on the back of his jersey. They didn't do it hockey style. They did it a little bit differently here. Put the C on the neck. And he was described as extremely businesslike by his coaches. Looking here, fires right away, incomplete. LeBlanc was the intended receiver. That one didn't work out. Third down and 7 coming up. Coverage by Travion Banks, who, by the way, 5 interceptions for number 6 in red on the season. Here's a huge third down.
It's going to be interesting right here. Miami cannot, they've got to build a quarterback trap. They can't let him scramble for first downs. This is a huge third and seven. They're going to go with a four-man rush. They've got to build a trap for the quarterback.
He steps up the pocket, throws right down the gut of the field. A catch made by Jamal Bell, who is a big play player. And he comes up with one there, down to the 36-yard line. First down, Raging Cajun.
Yeah, Bell just runs a dig. It's an inside route. Easiest throw in football, as long as there's a window. Lewis delivers the ball with a great decision, great accuracy, gives him an opportunity to run with the football after the catch. That was a huge first down.
Levi Lewis is the first Raging Cajuns quarterback in the program's history to throw for over 3,000 yards. He's having a brilliant, both quarterbacks. We only have, Gene, 7 incomplete passes tonight out of 40 that have been attempted.
Very impressive for both quarterbacks in terms of accuracy and decision making.
Back to the ground we go, and breaking tackles is Raymond Calais. Calais close to the first down, and a scuffle back at the 35-yard line. The officials quick to break it up. McWood on the stop. Good job by this American Conference crew to get in the way. Now a penalty marker has been found at the 39-yard line, so they may have discovered something in that scuffle.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct, defense number 58. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down. That's the first unsportsmanlike foul for number 58.
That is the first team All-MAC performer, Doug Costin.
Gets in a little tussle on the ground, it looks like. You know, sometimes those things happen. He's under the pile, fighting his way back out.
Well, he had a little two-point takedown there. If he ever wanted to get into wrestling, he showed some good form. But unfortunately, this isn't the place to do it. So he earns a spot on the bench for at least a play. A lot of movement there. Lewis is going to hang on to it. Ooh, man, you can hear that. He got hit. Cecil Singleton with the pop. Short gain there and a painful one.
Yeah, guys, Gene, you talked about the decision-making from Levi Lewis and how that's really improved. And Coach Napier said that's his biggest area of improvement this season in his preparation, his ability to understand his role, and his opponent's defense has grown tremendously this season. Last year, he was in on every fourth possession, which he believes really helped him to settle into his full-time role this season.
Lewis, I think he threw that away, Gene.
Well, it ties into what Lauren was just saying. He did throw that away. He saw that it was briefly open, but there was a defender tracking the ball. And that's when you got to sometimes throw it up and out of bounds, live for another down, never jeopardize the ball, especially when you're in the low red zone right now. You've got to come away with points. It's a one-score game. Be okay with kicking a field goal. This is 3rd and 8. You'll want a touchdown, right? They've been good at scoring touchdowns coming into this game. 69% of the time they've got down here, they've scored a touchdown. But right now, don't turn the ball over and come away with points.
Tunnel screen. Oh, this is a chance to be big. And it's a touchdown! Jamarcus Bradley. His second touchdown catch of the night.
I love the call. I love the call down here. 3rd and 8, safe play, right? Safe call. Let your athlete get the ball. Let those guys pull out in front of him. Let him locate some blockers and let him do something with the ball in his hands after the catch. Great job. Again, when you talk about the tunnel screens down here, it's really tough to defend in those short spaces because hats get on hats very quick from the pullers. Sometimes you only got to make one guy miss. Great job by Jamarcus Bradley.
24-10, 2:26 remaining. Levi Lewis tonight has thrown for 245 yards, both his touchdowns to Bradley, who's now 2 back of the great Brandon Stokely. I have to be honest, though, when I think of Louisiana football history, the first name that pops into my mind is Brian Mitchell.
Yeah.
Who was just an outstanding pro, who made a real career out of just being the guy who could do everything. Invaluable player for a couple of franchises, most notably Washington and Philadelphia. But Jamarcus Bradley, who knows what his future is going to be for this redshirt senior. He is going to be in the East-West Shrine Bowl.
you like to see guys who are fifth-year seniors? You know, those are kids that stuck around,
yep.
You know, stuck around through coaching changes, seen a lot happen in his 5 years. Here you are finishing up your last game of your senior year. Well, this is what you love seeing with guys that chose to stay, right?
So Miami now, two touchdowns back. It's positioned there, not comfortable. No team is comfortable, but Miami, you wonder, are they built to make the comeback? It's interesting, look at the, you've got Lewis, 18 completions for 245 yards. Gabbert is 16 of 18, but for only 121 yards. Very short kick. Thomas, can he get anything done? Well, he is trying, and he is really racked. Great coverage that time by the Raging Cajuns. A week from tonight at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ESPN and the ESPN app. We'll have the College Football Playoff National Championship game presented by AT&T at the Mercedes-Benz Superdome in New Orleans. It's Heisman winner Joe Burrow and top-ranked LSU, Trevor Lawrence, and number 3 Clemson. And we take a look at what's in store this postseason, brought to you by Macy's. We have a wide variety, as we always do, depending on your network. Everything from the main telecast, the coach's film room, which is my favorite. And we've got so much for you to choose from on that special night. To the ground go the Redhawks, outside the 25 with about the 28-yard line on the carry.
This is a critical drive, Dave, for them to score a touchdown. Let's go back. Two opening drives for Louisiana, touchdown, touchdown. Miami have answered after the first touchdown drive coming out of the half. They answer with a field goal. They can't answer with a field goal here. You can't match touchdowns for field goals. So this is going to be a really important drive. Look, guys, this game's going fast. There's a minute 45 left in the third quarter.
Yep.
So limited opportunities for possessions. This is going to be huge for them to have a touchdown drive.
Play action fake. Gabbert gets rid of it quickly. Who else but Sorensen? First down, Redhawks to the 45-yard line. 18 yards. Sorensen's 10th target and 9th catch. Gardner on the stop.
Nice RPO. I like that. Gabbert just wrote it in the belly. He's reading one defender. The one defender plays up. You have the bender by Sorensen. Catches it. Gives him a chance to run with the ball after the catch. They did it in the last series. Right now it's becoming kind of an easy throw and catch scenario for Gabbert.
And they mark it to the 46. First and 10 to the ground. That's Jalen Bester, and Bester gets into Louisiana territory. A gain of 7. Second down. Under a minute to go in this quarter. Bester again. That's going to be a first down. Took a few Louisiana defenders to ride him down. Joe Dillon being one of them, number 3. Gain of 5 there.
This is a sign of a well-coached football team. Miami now is giving some tempo to their offense. They are now pushing the envelope when it comes to, you know, getting the defense to get discombobulated. They're running the football right at them with tempo. I like the plan.
Gabbert. Throw incomplete off the hands of Jalen Walker. A little high for the 5'7" redshirt sophomore. Stops the clock with 18 seconds to go, second and 10.
One of the few times you've seen Gabbert off, right?
Mm-hmm.
The ball was still catchable. You got to hope that your receiver can come down with that. You put it a little bit behind him. And really, Dave, I mean, when you sit there and you look at the accuracy of Gabbert tonight, just remember, this kid's a true freshman. He's been pretty remarkable right now in his accuracy.
Gabbert with a little fake, has time, finds over the middle, and it's that time overthrown. Sorensen is campaigning for interference. He's not going to win. Jalen Johnson was in coverage.
He's going to try to hit an over route again, and here, this is where he's got to be careful. He hasn't really got himself in a position where he was in harm's way, but you got the defender playing underneath it and one over the top of it. You got to be very careful throwing into coverage like that. sure the coaches up in the box are going. Whew.
Third and 10, 13 seconds left in quarter number three. Gabbert, slant, Walker. First down, Miami. Guerra was all over Walker, and it didn't matter. And that will be the end of the third quarter with Miami on the move. They are not a team built to come from behind, but they're in a position to perhaps do so, or at least try to cut this Louisiana lead in half. Welcome back to the Lending Tree Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Fourth quarter about to begin here in Mobile with Louisiana from the Sun Belt leading the MAC champion Miami Redhawks 24-10. I'm Dave Lamont, joined upstairs by Gene Chizik. Lauren Sisler is watching the field for us. And by the way, Lauren will be your host for the postgame festivities that will be streaming after the game. First down for the Redhawks at the Louisiana 28-yard line. Brett Gabbert, 18 of 22 tonight for 153 yards. Tyrese Shelton, number 20, is the tailback. And Gabbert's going to keep it. Plays off a block, but that's not necessarily his thing. Jaquette is there, number 11. A little bit of help from Deuce Wallace. He did pick up two.
Well, the thing that it does more than anything is keep the defense honest. You know that he'll pull that. So you got to have a guy that can account for him. Down here, when you're getting close to the red zone, if you don't account for him, a 6 or 8 yard gain is huge down here. So I think it's a good call. Again, Louisiana's got to make sure they're always accounting for the quarterback, especially when they get down to this part of the field.
Gabbert in trouble, avoids the sack, chucks it, caught. Walker makes one spin. Walker with a great move, and he's elbowed out of bounds by Kibido at about the 16-yard line.
That was a great job of escaping by Brett Gabbert. Not only does he escape, he's able to come out of that and have the wherewithal to find the receiver, and he finds him. And again, what a great effort by Jalen Walker to finish that off for another enormous back-to-back first down that they had. Remember, it was third and long before that. Now, all of a sudden, they're continuing to move the chains.
To the ground, Bester. And Bester will get to about the 11. That's a solid five. Well, Miami in the last six games have been in the red zone 14 times. 8 times they have scored touchdowns.
Well, I'll say this, Miami has not changed anything. They've done some really good job of adjusting some tempo things. They're not changing anything. They're running the ball vertically, right up between the guards. They're throwing the perimeter game out there for easy access throws, spot screens, whatever they're giving them, they're taking them.
This is Tyrese Shelton. If he kicked it outside, he might have had a chance. He kicked it inside, it'll be a little short of the first down. Gang tackling by the Raging Cajuns. Third down and a yard coming up. 2 minutes already gone in this fourth quarter.
It's just a job where they give it to the tailback, and he has a decision right now to find where the seam is in the defense. He'll go ahead, he'll take the ball, he'll run it, he'll cut it back. And he's doing a good job right now finding seams and continue to move the chains.
They bring in Bester back. He is the leading rusher for this team, number one. They need a yard. Certainly two down territory.
Right now, Louisiana's got everybody up there.
Well, they went for the old-fashioned sneak, and it's going to be a first down. More substitutions for Miami as now they swap another running back into this drive. Davion Johnson will come in as Jalen Bester will come out. A lot of changes being made by the Redhawks here in the red zone. 13th play of the drive coming up. Bester bounces off and leaves in. Touchdown, Miami!
What an answer. What an answer. What a way to finish it off by Bester, of running the ball up inside and making a statement. Louisiana had a bunch of dudes up around the football.
Yeah, we've had a couple of looks at it, and it's very possible that Bester's knee might have been early. That could be what the booth says, although we've had another look at it. We got a couple of angles here. Did the ball beat the knee? I completely understand. Or did it, in this case, maybe his calf or shin got down there. Peter Vaz is the replay official who wants a closer look. First time we have called his name out tonight. If it's reversed, it will be second down and about yard to go. The issue was that I think it was his left leg down before the ball crossed the goal line. If it holds up, it will be Bester's second touchdown of the night. And it will be a championship drive answer by Miami.
Well, we talked about the importance of this not becoming a field goal drive, Dave. It's got to be a touchdown drive.
Now, the referee does not have the benefit of a video monitor, so he is strictly listening here to Voss. The ruling on the field is touchdown, Redhawks.
And I don't know if people really understand the mechanics of this, right? It is strictly on the replay official, the ones on the field right now. After they make the call, they're out of the picture.
Yep.
It's all straight on the replay official in the booth to make that call.
Well, I see a ball being marked at the one, but I don't know how they would have been able to communicate that. But whenever you see the notepad come out, that usually means you're trying to get the time right and everything else that goes with it. We're going to keep firing looks at you, and you can judge for yourselves. If he is down or not. Hand is on the ground. And we're waiting for Mike Roach. He wants to take the headset off. You can just by his body language, and here it comes off. So let's find out what the call is.
After further review, the runner's knee was down with the ball just short of the goal line inside the one. It'll be second down and goal just inside the one-yard line. The game clock will start on my signal.
All right, there you have it. So the touchdown comes off the board. It's 24-10 again. 14th play of the drive is next.
I wouldn't be surprised if, again, you look and you see him shift late, go to a quarterback sneak.
Second down and goal from the one. It's Bester again. We're not arguing about this one anymore.
Nope.
This one will stay on the board.
Play, 77-yard answer.
Tremendous football by Miami. The team that supposedly is not built to come from behind is a moment away from having the Louisiana lead from 14-7. But can they stop Louisiana on the subsequent drive, because the Raging Cajuns have moved the ball very well in the second half? Almost don't need to ask him to kick it. He's so automatic on the PATs. Louisiana's response is coming up. ...24-17, Miami coming back to cut the Louisiana lead in half with a brilliant drive. Now can they get a stop on the Raging Cajun? And we've had two touchdown games for Jalen Bester for Miami and Jamarcus Bradley, the receiver for Louisiana.
Well, Levi Lewis for Louisiana has been outstanding tonight. Dave, you and I were just talking about that. Think about the last two drives, back-to-back, nine-play touchdown drives for Louisiana. One was nine plays for 80 yards. One was nine for 70. And a lot of that was precipitated by the fact that Levi Lewis is really, really playing a heck of a football game.
Returnable kick here for Calais from the 5-yard line. He got a running start on this too, but ran into his own blocker and was able to wiggle his way to the 28-yard line. As we take a look at tonight's clutch delivery brought to you by Chipotle, we focus on the great wide receiver, Jamarcus Bradley. Found his way into the back of the end zone for one TD. Runs up the gut on the tunnel screen for his second touchdown. That's the one that made it 24-10, but Miami has bounced back. So here is yet another critical drive in this game. They'll open with Trey Regis at the running back spot. Lewis with a fake, in trouble, tough throw, incomplete at the 35-yard line. Lauren?
Dave, you just said it before the break. Miami is a team that is supposedly not built to come from behind, right? So Chuck Martin came over to his defense and posed this question to him. He said, can we win one when the script is flipped here? Let's be aggressive, keep our composure. We're going to get after these guys.
Well, it did on that play. A lot of pressure from Cameron Butler on Lewis forced the overthrow, second down and 10. Calais with it, cuts back against the grain and runs right into a slew of Redhawks. It'll be third down and 8 coming up.
Miami of Ohio did a great job of setting the edge. Cameron Butler all year long has really, really done a good job being stout on the run. Setting the edge of the defense is the name of the game, and Miami does it as good as anybody in their conference. That's why they were the number one defense in the MAC conference this year.
They have been outscored in the fourth quarter this year, 53-130. Big possession, big moment right here. Empty backfield, third and 8. Lewis, can he get to the first down? No. Oh my! High tackle, but did not grab a face mask. Lewis got 2 yards shy of the first down. Miles Reed got him.
Miles Reed does a great job of running sideline to sideline. He's done it all year. He came into the game with almost 80 tackles. What a great job of an open field tackle. Didn't grab the face mask, no horse collar, just a great open field tackle. And look, that's at a huge time, and that's a huge third down stop. Miami needed to have that to be able to get the ball back.
The first three and out against Louisiana tonight. So Reese Burns, been a while since he's kicked. Got a wobble on this one. And it was hit and down inside the 20 at about the 18, maybe the 19-yard line. And we're going to check it out when we return. Miami will go for the tying drive.
The Lending Tree Bowl, brought to you by Lending Tree. Shop and compare loans, credit cards, insurance, and more.
Just a little practical advice for the athlete who is bowling there. You got to keep your eye on a target. Balances off with a hip. May have used a little bit too much hand. I would consider, if I were him, going two-handed.
Yeah, follow through too, Dave.
Well, and that too, I think, increase the rev rate. Maybe move the target a little bit. You always make your first adjustment with your feet. So just a few tips, just trying to help a little
bit.
Not
that you've ever bowled before, right?
It's not so much that I haven't bowled a lot anymore. It's just that let's just say, Gene, I have had my share of watching. So here we go with Miami trying to get this drive going here. They start on the ground and don't get anything with it with Jalen Bester. It'll be second down and 10 coming up. And disruptive defense that time by the Raging Cajuns and Manac.
The last time Miami came out on the field, they had a 14-play, 77-yard touchdown drive that ate up almost 6 minutes. If they do the same thing here, you're looking at a tie game, giving the ball back to Louisiana with about 3 minutes and some change. And let's see how they attack the field here. I see corners playing off. There we go.
And Gabbert saw that too. Sorensen with a career high tonight in catches. That's his 10th first down to the 38-yard line.
I don't know how many times I can say it in the game, and you'd think that the coaches are seeing this right now, but I'm seeing a lot of off, soft corner play. And what's happening is Gabbert's just slicing and dicing those. Those don't have to be explosive 40-yard plays. They can be nickel and dime, right? 12-yard gains, 9-yard gains, 15-yard gains. But right now, if they keep playing off, they're going to get the same result.
Shelton, the tailback, number 20. He gets it. Pops through a hole, and he'll be stopped. 2 yards shy of the first down after an 8-yard pickup.
That time, Louisiana did not stack the box. They played a split safety look. They had two high safeties. Miami's simply counting the box. If you're light in the box, they're going to run it. If you're loading the box, they're going to find a way for an easy access throw, whether that's corner playing off of a throw it on the perimeter or some sort of screen game. But right now, they're just looking at the safeties. You see a split safety look, more than likely you're going to get a run.
Under 8 minutes left in the Lending Tree Bowl. Miami down 7. Gabbert with a play action fake. Wants a stop and go for Sorensen, and he was very well covered. You could see Sorensen stop and then take off again, but that time Eric Gehrer was right with him all the time.
Yeah, I love the coverage by Eric Gehrer. Here's a kid from Mobile over here at McGill Toolin. Did a great job. They've run that slant, that little hitch slant, several times tonight, setting him up for the double move. And Garrett's having no part of that. That was a nice job finishing the play by number 19, Eric Gehrer.
Stop the clock at 7:44. Third down and 2 coming up. It's an interesting play call here. You've got Bester, your top running back, back in.
Seeing a split safety look.
They go to the ground for Bester. This is close. Ball came out, but is ruled down. And it looks to me, Gene, that they are short.
Yeah,
so what do you do now if you're Chuck Martin?
I'm going to say Chuck Martin's going to say, you know what, guys? This is a physical game. This is how we like it. Let's go for it. Is that a little bit out of his world? Yes, because he's a guy that says punt it and play field position. But you know what? He's in the bowl game right now. His guys are moving the football. He's saying, hey, guess what, guys? This is a man's game. We're going to call it. They know we're going to run it. We're going to run it. And the best man's going to win. This is where you find out the guts of your football team.
They've only converted one of their last 7 on fourth down, and this leads to
ruling on the field that the runner was down before the ball became loose, and that the runner was short of the line to gain. That play is under further review.
Well, they got a couple things that they want to look at here. Now, Percy Butler was responsible for forcing the fumble. And if there's an immediate, let's go back and take a look at this whole thing. Because the issue is, the officials had him marked short of the first down. And then the issue is, if there is a fumble, was there an immediate recovery by the defense?
I don't see the ball.
Well, that's the tricky part.
Loose anywhere.
It looks like it starts to come out. We've had a couple of looks at it already. After his back is on the ground. And then it was recovered by Jaquan Nelson, number 97, for the Raging Cajuns. So, two things I guess the booth wants to look at. Fumble, fourth down, or first down. Now, I don't think first down is in play here, just after we went through that series of replays. I think that's going to stick.
It is. This is going to be all, where is the ball? Where are we spotting the ball? Did we spot the ball correctly? But going back to your point, Dave, earlier, you know, this is not normally Chuck Martin's going to punt this ball, play great defense, and try to win the game with field position, right?
But yeah, not now.
Not in this one.
No, not now. No. There was no sign of any punter coming out. I mean, you just might see Gabbert sneak under center again. We've seen that play work a couple of times. I mean, it's not like a 6'5" Peyton Manning or anything like that. It's a 6-foot freshman quarterback, but it works.
No, they just believe in the push of their offensive line.
Well, we all have had plenty of looks at it here in the booth, you all at home or on your devices, wherever you may be. So is it a first down, and is it still Miami ball? Right now, the ruling is it's Miami ball, but short of the first down. Now, another issue that's going on here is the clock. That's taking some time also. And this is, just imagine if somehow they reverse the call and give this ball to Louisiana, they would be first and 10 at around the 48-yard line in Miami territory.
Yeah, I'll be shocked if that's the result of this review.
I'll be honest, so am I, but this is taking an extraordinarily long time.
After further review, the runner fumbled the ball, and there was a clear recovery by number 97 of the defense. With the Louisiana's ball at the 48-yard line, please reset the game clock to 7 minutes, 35 seconds, 7:35. The game clock will start on my signal.
So there you have it.
Wow.
The first turnover of the game. Louisiana has now forced a turnover in 8 straight games.
There must be an angle that I can't see. I couldn't see it, Dave. I just never saw the ball loose before his back hit.
Well, I'll be honest with you, Gene. If we can't see the angle, how do they see the angle?
I don't know.
We share the same.
Because it's got to be a definitive. It's got to be definitive. Do you see it definitive?
Not definitive. Not to me.
To overchange, to yeah. Turn the call, overturn the call. There's got to be definitive evidence, and I just didn't see it.
However, the call is in favor of the Raging Cajuns.
It is.
We're moving on. We're on to Cincinnati, as Bill Belichick once said. First and 10, 48-yard line for Louisiana, and they'll go to the ground. They'll go to Mitchell, who's played well. He breaks tackles. He carries tacklers, and Mitchell will have a first down for Louisiana.
This is the part of the game when you say, I don't care how many people are stacked in there. We're up by 7. There's 7 minutes left in the game. We're going to run the football. I'm on the plus side of the field. Guys, you got to knock them off the ball. 3-yard gain, 4-yard gain. Let the running back do the rest.
And you think about the emotional blow that Miami just took, too. Mitchell, 1,000-yard rusher this year for Billy Napier and his Raging Cajuns. Lewin, scrambling. He can keep it. He will. Stays in bounds and picked up a few extra yards. Looked like he might go out early to save himself, but he saw he had some extra room. Another first down for Louisiana, and another big play by Levi Lewis.
Man, he's just got a good feel for the game. I love watching quarterbacks that know where they are. They know where the first down is. They know. Look, we know he's a good athlete, right? But when you sit there and you look at his football IQ, his decision-making, having a feel for where the sticks are, this is what differentiates really, really good quarterbacks from really great ones.
And Lewis gonna keep it. He stumbled, spins, and falls forward to the 21-yard line for 5. Yeah, his smarts have been off the charts tonight. You can see why, again, he was almost unanimously elected to captain by the players on this team.
And let's be mindful, he's only a junior.
Yeah.
And typically those spots go to your seniors, right? But look, when you have a junior that's this much of the alpha in the room, of course, him playing tonight and us watching him live, we can figure out why he is that.
Well, he has over 300 total yards now when you count his rushing and passing. A lot of movement. It's Mitchell spinning in traffic. Dragged down short of the first down. But meantime, look at the clock. 5:41 and rolling along. Third down and short coming up here for Louisiana. They also have a good kicker.
That's one of the things that Elijah Mitchell does so well is yards after contact. He got hit right around the line of scrimmage. Still managed to gain 3 to 4 yards on the carry.
Well, it's pretty close. Stayed in bounds. That's a big thing. Williams, did he get that first down?
Doesn't look like it. Looks like he's a little short.
Well, now what? Bleed the clock, call a timeout, kick a field goal, go for it, and really make things difficult for Miami.
Well, you know, for me, as long as I've got a field goal kicker that I feel good with, I'm making it a two-score game. I know it's fourth and inches. That's me personally, but I'm a conservative guy, Dave.
But here's, I think we both agree what Billy Napier's doing now. He's taking 20 extra seconds off the clock almost,
sure, right.
And he's going to take a timeout, and he stops the clock with 4:39 remaining. So we'll see what the decision is. Will it be Stevie R take the kicker, or will they go for it on fourth down? We invite you fans to tune in to the ESPN app for the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One immediately following the game. Gene and I have some thoughts, and Lauren Sisler will take you through the trophy presentation. And after the decision here, Stevie Artig is on for a 33-yard field goal. He is 1-for-1 tonight. Out of the hold of Bam Jackson. Flags down. This could be a 38-yard field goal, or is it an offsides? Boy, there was a lot of movement.
False start. Kicking team, number 63. It's a 5-yard penalty, fourth down.
Still a manageable field goal for Artig, whose long of the season is 53.
Looks like the left tackle. The sudden movement.
All right, you know how many false starts that is now? You almost said it.
I'm going to guess six.
Correct.
Six false starts.
Six false starts on the Raging Cajuns tonight.
Well, good thing for Louisiana, their kicker has made the last 13 out of 14 under 50 yards, so they still ought to feel extremely confident in the kick.
Yeah, Bam Jackson was actually too far back. The holder was a yard farther back than he needed to be. It's a 38-yard kick. He's reset. Plenty of time to get it off. It is on the way. It is certainly long enough. And he nailed it. So the overturn on the call of the field leads to three Raging Cajun points, and the Sun Belt runners-up have now made this a two-score game.
Well, when you got a kicker like Artig that's money, you feel good with making this a two-score game. That's the bottom line. They really didn't have a choice, Dave, right? I mean, they needed to make it. I mean, you can say, hey, it's fourth and a foot, but you're also playing against a Miami defense that is number six in the country in tackles for loss. They average over eight a game. And you can't take that risk. When you can make it a two-score game, give it back to a Miami offense that's not really built for no huddle. They got to score twice with 4 minutes and 30 seconds left. I'm going to roll the dice. I'm going to put my kicker out there and let him make it a two-score game. So I thought that was a good call.
So Miami will ask Maurice Thomas on the kick return to give them good field position. So far, the kick coverage for both teams has been excellent. And Artig handling the kickoff tonight as well. He doesn't always do that, but he's doing it this evening. So he's got to be a little bit juiced up, I would think, after kicking what might be the clincher for Louisiana.
To be kept on the field.
Pretty good kick. Going to be to the goal line. Here comes Maurice Thomas. Hit once, hit a lot. Excellent kick coverage yet again, this time by Louisiana special teams. He'll only get out to the 20-yard line. SportsCenter tonight, after our game with Steve Levy and John Anderson. Mel Kiper Jr. joins the show with the latest on Tua's draft decision, plus Ed Warder from Dallas and the Cowboys hiring Mike McCarthy. And when will Zion Williamson make his NBA debut? SportsCenter after the conclusion of our game on ESPN and the ESPN app. And I'm sure some highlights from this game as well. It's been a fun one here at Ladd Peebles, the Lending Tree Bowl. And we've been told the play clock is not working. So the officials will be in charge of that. Our apologies, that is out of our hands. Gabbert pitches incomplete. Sorensen, the intended receiver, second and 10. Clock stopped at 4:25. If you're Miami, regardless of outcome here, you've got this guy for three more years as your quarterback if he can stay healthy.
Yeah, you got to be excited about it. You know, this year they won games by playing great defense, great special teams, and not turning the ball over. They didn't necessarily count on their offense for a lot of points, but I can tell you moving down the road, this Miami offense will score a lot of points because you got a guy throwing it right now that can, he can deal it out there.
Gabbert in trouble, hit as he throws his pass. Intercepted! Percy Butler has it, and Butler gets it inside the 30-yard line. There's a marker down. The penalty marker is at the 41-yard line.
Pass interference, defense, number 59. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
That's a huge call.
Okay.
Huge call on Boudreau.
Yep.
Making contact down the field while the ball's in the air. John Boudreau's been one of their best, most productive players, one of the leaders of this defense all year. Very untimely PI call.
Ninth penalty on Louisiana, and a stunner there. Miami has life. Play action fake. Gabbert going to take a deep shot. Has a man open. Caught 20-yard line. To the 10. To the 5. Fighting for the end zone for the extra yard. Down to the 2-yard line. The play made by James May.
Wow.
He and Tariq Miller get into a wrestling match, and May dragged him for additional yardage.
What an answer. What an answer. James May's been their big play guy all year long. Run to the post. Gabbert puts the ball. The only place he can put it to keep him on the run. He takes the ball down to the low red zone, right around the 3-yard line. Look at him just outrun the coverage.
Well, he's got a linebacker on him there. We had Blakely shaken up briefly for Louisiana. Excuse, let me correct that. That was a Louisiana player, not Blakely. That was Kendall Wilkerson who was shaken up. He limped off the field with the athletic training staff. 4 minutes and a second to go. First and goal from the 2-yard line.
Well, 34 seconds is ticked off the clock, so they're down on the 3-yard line. Pretty quick. You're going to see him again try to punch the ball in. They're going to run it down here. What have they had success with than they got down here? Bester on the inside zones is what you've seen them have a lot of success with.
He's going to play action. Fake. Too high. Incomplete. Trying to go to the tight end. Homer. Gabbert got dumped that time as Penisco came in unblocked.
This is where you got to be very careful down here. Obviously, you got to also watch where the clock is, right? It's at 3:44.
All already getting ready for an onside kick.
Yeah, keep in mind it's a two-score game, right? So you're trying to preserve time. That's why you saw him throw it on first down. But at some point, you have to go to what you're best at, right? That's running the football down here. And that's where you see Jalen Bester been their guy.
Two touchdowns already on the ground for number one. Gabbert again, slant pattern, deflected. Third and goal, only 4 seconds went off the clock. And that was Pettisglow who had come up big earlier, the time he got a hand on it.
Next thing to keep that you need to remember is that you can still kick a field goal here, right? They would prefer a touchdown, it's a two-score game.
You can kick a field goal, you're right, but
That's not what they prefer,
no,
obviously.
I know what you're thinking. You need two scores, and one of them should be a field goal, and you're thinking, but man.
Yeah, I just, you know, this is going to be three passes in a row, which is interesting.
Bester, no, he didn't get it. And again, the ball came out. The head linesman definitively announcing that the ball is down, but it's fourth and goal at the one.
You know, it really is just kind of backwards from what I was thinking. I'm thinking you run Bester on those first couple of downs, right?
But do you run Gabbert on that sneak here? No, bad snap! Unbelievable! How does that happen?
Wow.
One of the most stunning plays of this entire bowl season, right there.
Unbelievable turn of events.
It'll be first down at the 24-yard line for the Raging Cajuns with 3 minutes and 7 seconds remaining.
Wow.
What a gut punch for Miami that they have to take. That's what's going to go to the winner. Lauren Sister will be your host. 3:07 remaining, and somebody will be hoisting that trophy here in Mobile. As everybody is just looking at each other, what did we just see there? Louisiana in a position to lock this game down, lock down their 11th win, the greatest season in program history. They got to lock it down, and it's not going to be easy. Not much there, maybe two, maybe three on the extra effort by Trey Regis. They have two left. The play clocks are working again, I'm happy to report, or at least they're testing them out. So big miscues, big mistakes may define this game from the Redhawks' perspective. That was ruled eventually after a replay overturn. What was not called a fumble was called a fumble, and this shocker, the fourth down turnover with Gabbert unable to get that low snap. He was a little bit shaken on the play. I think somebody stepped on his leg in the scramble for it. So you see what's happened. Turnover on downs and the lost fumble for Miami. They stopped the clock with 1 second and 3 minutes to go.
Yeah, essentially two turnovers, right? One was on downs and one, you know, and again, the way they win games at Miami is to play great defense, not turn the ball over. And up to that point, it was pretty much going as scripted.
To the ground. Regis again. Clock stopped again after 7 seconds used on that play. Weekend tonight at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ESPN on the ESPN app. One of the College Football Playoff National Championship games presented by AT&T at the Mercedes-Benz Superdome in New Orleans. It's Heisman winner Joe Burrow and number one LSU taking on Trevor Lawrence and number three Clemson. Could anybody stop that Montana to Rice passing attack that LSU seems to have? That's what I keep thinking. That somewhere in heaven, Bill Walsh is looking at that going, that's how you play offense.
Yeah, you know, it's amazing that you've got two quarterbacks in this game that, you know, Trevor Lawrence didn't get the credit this year that, you know, maybe he should have, because earlier in the year, you know, he turned the ball over a couple times starting in the Georgia Tech game. But I'm going to tell you something. Yeah, I've watched the film of his last seven or so games. I'm not sure there's a hotter quarterback on the planet. You're looking at the two hottest. I can tell you that right now.
Yeah.
And it's just going to be amazing to see what Dave Aranda and Brent Venables have to scheme up to be able to stop both offenses. Because let's be honest, they've got a lot of firepower on both sides.
We just did a quick check on the ESPN app and ESPN.com. Right now, Louisiana has a 99.6% chance of winning. Up two scores with the football. Third and five. Lewis running all the way. Didn't get there. He's going to be short a yard.
And Ohio
takes its final timeout of the half.
So Miami does not have another timeout left. And Levi Lewis has been absolutely magnificent. And he is our Capital One player of the game.
Well, it's his athletic ability. It's his decision-making, you know, never putting the ball in harm's way, meaning that don't throw into coverage. If guys are covered, do something with the ball in your hands. Extend the play with your feet. If the guys are open, get the ball in there. Make quick decisions. Throw it accurately. And he really has done all of the above tonight. And the fact that he's this unbelievable leader in the locker room, the alpha male, the businesslike guy, and you got him for another year, that's got to make Billy Napier one happy man. Of course, when he talked about him yesterday in the meetings, he was all smiles anyway, but now we see why.
How about the fact that Louisiana's getting Billy Napier back? There were so many rumors, particularly when the Mississippi State job opened up, that Billy Napier would be a candidate. He had to deny it more than once when it was first reported by our old friend Brett McMurphy. Here's the punt from Burns. Thomas, big fair catch. Boy, he had to work hard to find that one, and Burns tucks him inside the 20-yard line yet again. So the Redhawks do not have any timeouts left. They are down by 10. They have 2 minutes and 44 seconds.
Well, this is Dave, where you really find out the execution of your offense in these two-minute drills, right? So they're still it's still a two-point game or a two-score game. You got 2 minutes and 44 seconds left. There's going to be have to be a lot of throwing catches. And look, they're going to have to throw for first downs here. They're going to have some clock stoppages. You can't be throwing the ball at 5 yards and having guys get tackled. These are going to have to be, you know, what we call diamond quarter throws, 10 and 20-yard throws completion-wise, because you got to get that clock stop or get out of bounds. Good start.
That's the catch is made there, but number 19, James May, but that's only for 4 yards. That's not even a nickel. Second down and 6.
Looking for ways to stop the clock and be mindful that that doesn't stop the clock continuously with 2 minutes and 30 seconds left in the game. The clock begins.
Gabbert couldn't find anybody. He's going to sprint to get out of bounds and did so. Gardner, who we know can hit, Gabbert knows it too. So he got out of there before Gardner could hurt him. Gain of 5. Clock temporarily stopped at 2 and 24.
They got to hurry up. They got to be getting to the line of scrimmage. There's got to be an urgency in the game. The clock is running. We can't walk up to the line of scrimmage. This is the urgency of the game. Everybody's got to be on this up-tempo.
The empty backfield set. Gabbert needs a first down. And intended for Homer. Batted down by Cameron Solomon, number 27. It's fourth down.
Boy, that was a huge defensive play by Cameron Solomon. Great job being in position to what we call long arm the ball, right? Stick your arm, your off arm in front of the ball and make the play. Great job. That was a huge third down stop. One more play and this game may be over if Louisiana can get a stop here.
And Miami cannot stop the clock with a timeout. Gabbert scrambling. Sack! That's it! The one, a couple of things that couldn't happen just happened. Sacked. Done by Zion Hill, the redshirt sophomore. That's sack number 3 tonight.
Zion Hill, when you talk to the coaches, they're going to tell you he's one of the best players on the defense. He's a 6 foot, 280-pound guy that can rush the passer. Second team all-conference guy, and what a big play at the right time for Zion Hill.
And Chris Moncrief, also number 6, will share in that sack. So it's first down for Billy Napier's Cajuns, who are looking to go to an 11-3 season. That's the greatest season in Louisiana football history. It's going to wrap up here in Mobile. You saw the graphic earlier. Louisiana, who you may used to have known as Louisiana Lafayette, no longer. They are just the University of Louisiana. Had not won a bowl game outside that great state since the 1940s, the Oil Bowl. That's incredible to me.
Well, it appears that Billy Napier will be here for at least one more year. I think one of the reasons that he isn't in any hurry to leave is that, you know, he feels like he's built something, and, you know, he's got a lot of guys returning, including the quarterback. So, you know, there's no reason to rush out of Louisiana.
I just want to interrupt you. Classy gesture by Chuck Martin here. He's taking out some players, and he turned to the crowd and asked them to stand up to recognize them as they came off the field. He knows look. They did everything they could.
Absolutely.
It wasn't their night tonight. A couple of mistakes in the fourth quarter doomed them. But they acquitted themselves very well. They won a MAC championship that they were not favored to win the East. That was Ohio. Then they were underdogs against Central Michigan. Had Western Michigan won the division, they would have been underdogs against the Broncos, too. A lot of people didn't believe them. They lost by, what, 71? 70 right. At Ohio State? Or
yeah, it was a beatdown. And they started 1-3.
Yeah.
And look, he did this with a freshman quarterback. And let's give Chuck a lot of credit. I don't think people realize when he got there the condition that this Miami program was in. They had lost 19 straight games. He went in there and was like, does anybody in here love the game of football? And
he didn't like the answer.
He really didn't. And look, hats off to both of these coaches. Great seasons for both of them. And we wish them well for sure.
Crown of champions of the Lending Tree Bowl. The Raging Cajuns of Louisiana. Billy Napier gets the bowl win. And he earned it. What a night for Levi Lewis. Two touchdowns for Jamarcus Bradley. And a victory for Louisiana. And a new standard for them in their football history. And what a great way to end the bowl season. We just got one game left in the Sugar Bowl, in the Superdome.
That'd be a pretty good one, won't it?
Can't wait, man. Can't wait. Good luck trying to figure that one out. Our player of the game, Levi Lewis. And let's go down to the field and Lauren.
Yeah, our player of the game, Levi Lewis, eclipsing 3,000 yards for this season tonight. Describe his performance and how he really managed this football game.
Well, I thought our staff did a great job making some adjustments at halftime. You know, he kind of put the ball in his hands. He did an outstanding job. Guy who's the leading vote getter on our team for team captains as a junior. Been a terrific leader and set a great example for the team. Proud of this group of seniors, man. This is a special group, bought into what we were selling 2 years ago, building great relationships and great trust. So proud of this group, man. This is well deserved.
You get a record 10 wins. Now add that, make that 11. 11 wins for your program. How special is it to go out on a high note like this?
Well, we got great people. You know, we got a terrific staff, great administration. They had a great vision of what they wanted to accomplish. They gave us the resources, went out and hired a great staff, and the players have been outstanding. You know, we got a terrific group of seniors. We got a great group of walk-ons on this team that have really been our heartbeat. You know, they've been impressive. Proud of this group, man. It's been a lot of fun.
Thanks so much, Coach. Enjoy this one.
All right. Thank you all.
I think those two may be talking to each other again very shortly when the trophy is handed out. Hope you enjoyed this one. We certainly enjoyed bringing it to you. Our final score for the final time, Louisiana beats Miami 27-17. For Gene Chizik and Lauren Sisler, and thanks to our wonderful crew, I am Dave Lamont. Thank you for watching. We say good night from Mobile. Now, let's get you to SportsCenter. Welcome to the Lending Tree Bowl, a trophy ceremony presented by Capital One. The festivities down in the field are about to begin. But first, this message. Promise that you'll never find another like me.
With the Capital One Saver Card, you earn 4% cash back on dining and 4% on entertainment. So when you go out, you cash in. What's in your wallet?
Let's take a look at today's Capital One rewarding performance. And our player of the game, Louisiana's Levi Lewis. Gene, he was brilliant.
I loved everything he did tonight, Dave. And again, when I look at quarterbacks and evaluate guys, I look at decision makers. I look at guys that are accurate with the football. I look at guys that protect the football. And he did everything tonight. When guys weren't open, he would make plays with his feet. When guys were open, he was accurate with the football. He runs this team. He manages the game. He has fun doing what he's doing, and he's a fantastic leader. And what more can you ask for in a quarterback? The great ones that I've been around do all those things, and he certainly did it tonight.
You see his numbers, 19 to 26. He got a couple of touchdown passes to Jamarcus Bradley. He ran when he needed to run. He made the RPOs work. He did just about everything as well as you can do it. Was not sacked. And by the way, Louisiana does not give up very many sacks, only 14 all season long. They were not able to get to him tonight. Well, the Raging Cajuns did get to Gabbert three times. And the last one, of course, Brett Gabbert was sacked on what turned out to be the final play from scrimmage for the season for Miami, when he was sacked on a fourth down as the Red Hawks are trying to come from two scores back with time running out. Odds were certainly against them, but they played as well as they could have possibly played, and just not able to come from behind. They're not built that way, as we talked about during the broadcast a few times, but certainly for them, a terrific season, and probably more important for them to be MAC champions.
Yeah, and again, you know, this game tonight was close, and they played well.
Let's head down to the field. Lauren Sisler has the trophy presentation.
First and foremost, I want to congratulate both football teams for participating tonight in the 2020 Lending Tree Bowl. Here tonight, the Raging Cajuns coming out with the win, 27-17. Your Lending Tree Bowl champions for this evening. Again, congratulations to both football teams for all of your accomplishments this season. Well done, everyone out there. We'll first start by presenting our awards for tonight. Joining me here on stage, we have Rob Brown with Lending Tree, as well as Lending Tree Bowl President, Mr. Jerry Silverstein. And the first award we're going to hand out tonight, most valuable player, goes to number one quarterback, Levi Lewis. Levi tells us we need to put the O-line on this award here. What do you think about that, O-line? Next is tonight's most valuable defensive player, and that goes to number 19 defensive back, Eric Guerrero.
From the crib.
Yeah. Our next award tonight going to the most valuable offensive player, number 2, Jamarcus Bradley. And last but not least, congratulating our special teams player of the game, number 36 place kicker, Stevie Artigue. All right, Rob Brown is going to step in here now with the hardware, the big dog.
Let the coach in.
Rob Brown presenting the Lending Tree Bowl trophy here to Coach Billy Napier. So I'll start here with Coach. Coach, a very special one here tonight. For some of these seniors, for all of these seniors, the first bowl game they have won here at Louisiana. How special is this win for you and your guys?
I think, first of all, how about a shout out to our fans, our alumni, and our students that were here tonight, baby. You know, we're fortunate at the University of Louisiana that we've got great administration, we've got great leadership in Dr. Savoy and Dr. Maggard.
gave us the resources to go out and hire a terrific staff. 2 years ago, we started working really hard with these players on relationships, building great trust, and this seniors, they've been a great example to the rest of the team. Can't thank them enough for what they've done to help our program. Tonight's the cap off of a lot of hard work, man. It started back in January. We're very proud of this team and this staff.
When you look at your quarterback over here, Levi Lewis, you said he's the guy that everybody wants to hire. He's the guy that will go to work for you. How do you describe his performance tonight and his ability to manage this offense and get you guys this win?
Well, Levi is the product of his work. You know, the guy's been relentless. You know, it was his time. He started back in January, set a great example of his teammates for how to prepare, how to be a worker. Guy's detailed. He's relentless. The leading vote getter by our team for the captains this year as a junior. Guy's been winning football games for a long time, man. Did it in high school, and he's done it here at UL. And couldn't be more proud of Levi and how he played tonight when it mattered the most.
Let's talk about this defense, the resilience, the fight. Describe their performance tonight.
Well, first off, you got to give hats off to Coach Roberts and the defensive staff. They had a terrific plan. You know, we play a lot of players on defense, man. We play 22 guys most games. It's been great at every level of the defense. We've got good play up front, good play by the backers, and great play in the back end. It's team defense, man, and tonight was a great example. 17 points, that's about where we've been all year, top 20 in the country, and a major turnaround, you know, an improvement from year one to year two. So hats off to the players and the staff for what they did tonight on defense.
All right, we're going to turn this thing over to Levi Lewis now. The junior quarterback eclipsing the 3,000-yard mark tonight. What can you say about this football team, the guys you've gone to work with all season long, closing this thing out and getting your first bowl win for the senior class?
Well, first, I just want to give thanks to my God. You know, just thank him first and foremost. Everybody just do their job. O-line do their job. Everybody just does their job. They come in and work every day. So that's what happens.
You guys were obviously out there continuing to fight. They obviously scratched and clawed, gave you guys a run for your money there towards the end of the football game. What was the biggest key factor in keeping you guys on top and obviously getting out of here with a 27-17 win?
I'll say just staying hungry, sticking to the game plan, and just keeping our focus, you know, just staying in front, not getting the big head, and just staying focused for the most part.
Okay, the most important question of all, how are you going to celebrate this one tonight?
We really... Oh! Hey, there you have it. There you have it. There you have it right there.
Again, congratulations to the Raging Cajuns for the Lending Tree Bowl win tonight, 27-17. Put up that trophy. Celebrate this one. Enjoy it tonight. Congratulations to these guys. We'll see you later.